Madam Clerk, we are calling this meeting to order. It is Tuesday, November 22nd, 2016.
This is to inform the general public that this meeting is being held in compliance with Section 5 of the Open Public Meetings Act, Chapter 231, Public Law 1975. A notice of this meeting was emailed to the Star Ledger and the West Orange Chronicle on October 14th, 2015. A notice of this meeting was also posted on the bulletin board in the Municipal Building, West Orange, and filed in the office of the Municipal Clerk of the Township of West Orange on October 14th, 2015. Councilwoman Castellino?
Present.
Councilman Guarino?
Present.
Councilman Krokoviac?
Present.
Councilwoman McCartney?
Present.
Council President Cirillo?
Present.
Mayor Parisi?
Thank you very much, Madam Clerk, and thank you all for being here tonight. It's great to see so many people. And I'm sure you're staying for the full 4 hours, right?
Four.
Exciting. We're going to get started with a very special ceremony. We have the West Orange Fire Department here for a special promotional ceremony. At this point, we are going to call the Honor Guard. Thank you for that presentation of colors. We are going to go into the Pledge of Allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Order your arms.
Thank you all. God bless America. At this point, we are going to call Father James Ferry, Our Lady of Lourdes Church, for an invocation.
We ask God's blessing in the name of the Father, Son, and Spirit. Amen. God, our shelter and strength, we thank you for bringing us here together. We pray for all of our brothers and sisters who serve in the West Orange Fire Department. Especially in a special way, we pray for the leadership of the fire department, for their wisdom and strength, and for Captain Carmen Ruda, promoted today, and for his family. We ask all things in your name. Amen.
Amen.
Father Chief, Fire Chief Peter Smeraldo.
You got promoted.
Wow. We have two priests here, so.
I think I have to go to confession first before I go to Father. Yeah. Please be seated. Thank you.
Now's the time.
Bless me, Father, for I've sinned. And I'll, Anyway, welcome everyone. I want to welcome you to our promotion ceremony. First, I want to thank Mayor Parisi for putting this day together for us. And it's always an honor and privilege to be here to be the MC, so to speak, the host of another promotional ceremony that I get to partake in. I want to thank the Council President for accommodating us and members of the Council, Madam Clerk, for allowing us to be here today. And it's a wonderful day. I want to thank everybody for coming today, family, friends, and all dignitaries. Welcome, happy Thanksgiving, before I forget, and I want to say thank you for joining us. Today is a special day. We're here to promote one of our own, Captain or Firefighter Carmine Ruda, who will be elevated soon to the position of Fire Captain, which is really the backbone position of our department. We rely heavily on our captains. The captains are the leaders of the companies. You know, they execute all the decisions and orders on the fire ground. And their judgment, their decision-making, their wisdom is what makes events successful. And as an example of that, tonight, just moments before we joined here today, we just had a rollover on Northfield Avenue that, thankfully, based on the decisions of our members, they were successfully able to extricate the person. And she was taken to St. Barnabas Hospital, my understanding, which is a good sign, because when you go to St. Barnabas, it's a lot better than having to go down to university because of the trauma. So, and I think that speaks volumes to the dedication, commitment, and duty that the members of this department display every day, every single day, every single moment. And Carmine is a reflection of that. He's part of our team. He's part of what we've done in this agency. He's helped build it grow since he joined the department in July of 2006. And now it's 10 years later or so, and it's time for him to step up to the next position, which I'm confident that he's going to do a fantastic job in his role. He's already started in that role, partially in assuming the duties of the EMS officer back last summer, and that's a vital link now to our agency, as we know that we've changed our mission over the last year and a half. So I want to thank Carm for his dedication into the job. I want to thank him for doing his job diligently, and I want to thank him for sitting here patiently listening to me talk so he can get up here and get promoted. So without further ado, I'd like to present Firefighter Carmine Ruta.
Multitasking.
Ready? I state your name.
I, Carmine Ruta.
Do solemnly swear.
Do solemnly swear.
That I will support the Constitution of the United States.
That I will support the Constitution of the United States.
And the Constitution.
And the Constitution.
Of the State of New Jersey.
Of the State of New Jersey.
And that I will bear true faith.
And I will bear true faith.
And allegiance to the same.
And allegiance to the same.
And to the governments established.
And to the governments established.
In the United States.
In the United States.
And in this state.
And in this state.
Under the authority of the people.
Under the authority of the people.
I do further solemnly swear.
I do further solemnly swear.
That I will faithfully.
That I will faithfully.
Impartially.
Impartially.
And justly perform.
And justly perform.
All of the duties.
All of the duties.
Of the office of fire captain.
Of the office of fire captain.
According to the best of my ability.
According to the best of my ability.
So help me God.
So help me God.
Congratulations.
Thank you. You.
As our tradition dictates, it's not easy to get to this position, and it takes a lot of time and dedication away from the family. So what we do on behalf of the fire department, to its family members, we want to present you with some flowers just for putting up with all our nonsense.
I just want to say thank you very much for friends, family, and all the guys in the back for coming out today. Thank you to the council for hosting us tonight, Mr. Sayers, Mr. Mayor. I really don't know what to say, to be honest with you right now. I'm kind of just so happy about this. But I hope everybody has a happy and healthy holiday season, and thank you very much.
Council President, I want to thank you again for letting us to take time out of your busy schedule. I know that, and I want to thank you for all you do in supporting us. And I want to wish you and the members of council and your families a happy and healthy holiday season, a happy Thanksgiving. I believe, Carm, is an invitation to the
yes.
High Lawn Pavilion? Oh, no. the West Orange Elks at Main Street. So you said yes too quick. Thank you very much. Have a good evening.
Thank you. stay the course.
We're going to move on to the next item on the agenda, Madam Clerk. Moving on to a special 85th anniversary recognition of St. Joseph's Church.
Yes.
So I'm going to call Father Dominic. At this point, as you know, I like history, so I want to give a little background on the history of St. Joseph's Church. I'm going to make it quick, Father,
sure.
and just putting in a good word for the fire chief as well. So we're going to get started. As you know, St. Joseph's Church is in the St. Cloud neighborhood. The neighborhood in 1931 had yet to be developed. We had farms, cottages. It was a retreat for a lot of folks that that came over from Manhattan. One of them, one of those families was the Schindler family. The Schindler family, headed by Charles Schindler. He was a big magnate in the printing business in Manhattan, and they settled at Ridgway Avenue. And he passed in 1927, and in his honor, Mrs. Schindler dedicated 2 acres of land at that time on Benvenue Avenue to the parish that at that time was in the process of coming together as a church. The parish eventually gained the approval in 1931. So the first mass that was held at St. Joseph's Church was on Christmas Day, 1931. There were 2 masses, one at 8 o'clock in the morning and one at 10 a.m. in the morning. And again, the family paid, not only did they donate the 2 acres of land, but they also paid for the construction of the church at that time. And then over time, the St. Cloud neighborhood continued to develop, and the church fell a need due to the increase in membership to increase their land at that time. So from 1938 to 1952, there were 4 additional land purchases, which eventually led to the size of the lot now that we have, and led to the building of a school, and also the parking lot that we're blessed with every Sunday, as well as eventually a gymnasium was built in 2010, was when it was eventually dedicated. So it's been 85 years of church, and as you know, church, the definition of oftentimes they say the definition of church is really not a building, but the people that come together on Sundays or every day to Mass and practice their faith. So St. Joseph's Church, living in a neighborhood, is not only like physically impressive and a beautiful church, but definitely what makes it special is the parishioners who come together in harmony and joy and practice their faith. And tonight we're going to celebrate 85 years of church and commitment by wishing St. Joseph's Church, on behalf of the council, on behalf of the public, and everyone at home, happy birthday, happy anniversary. And at this point, I would like to yield the floor to Father Dominic, who would like to say a few words, and also invite all of you to the special luncheon on December 4th. Father Dominic.
And thank you. It's a very exciting time right now at St. Joseph. And yes, celebrating 85-year anniversary. In fact, just 1 month ago, Charles Schindler, again, a founder of the parish, I celebrated the wedding for his great-great-granddaughter. So it was wonderful. We had the whole family there as we got to look back and see, you know, a few generations later, especially at this time as we're about to celebrate our 85th anniversary. And yes, the anniversary is going to take place on Sunday, December 4th. So really just 2 weeks away, a week and a half away. The actual first Mass was on Christmas in 1931. Now, of course, we couldn't have the celebration on Christmas, so we had it a few weeks a few weeks earlier in December. And as I said, we're very excited about it. The celebration of the liturgy on December 4th will be at 11:30 a.m. It will be our 11:30 Mass. And we have one of our bishops from the Archdiocese is coming to celebrate the Mass, Bishop John Felici of the Archdiocese of Newark. So he will celebrate the liturgy. I will concelebrate with him along with the other priests from St. Joseph. And we've invited former priests from St. Joseph. We're hoping to see if some of them are able to come and concelebrate the liturgy with us. We're excited about that liturgy. And following the Mass, then we're having a reception in our parish hall. In fact, we put together a committee of our parishioners who are planning the reception and doing a wonderful job. And what's great to see is their enthusiasm, their excitement. But again, it's so much history as we look back through the 85 years, and really now it's a celebration of community. So we're truly coming together as a parish family as we celebrate the 85 years of St. Joseph. So I want to thank you for this opportunity tonight, and it's good to be with you, and you're all welcome. Welcome, Sunday, December 4th at St. Joseph Church, 11:30 a.m. Thank you.
So we're going to extend this proclamation to Father Dominic and the congregation. It says, the West Orange Council wishes to congratulate and celebrate St. Joseph's Parish on the occasion of its 85th anniversary and looks forward to continuing to work together and assisting West Orange with its many opportunities and challenges. Congratulations and thank you again.
Great. Thank you.
We're going to move on with our conference agenda. We have Perry Bashkoff, our social media consultant, here to give us an update on what's going on in the social media world, the issue with the fake news. What's going on with that?
That's a good question. Does that really exist? Hey, everybody. So it's hard to think that just 3 years ago, social media didn't really exist in West Orange. I know I got involved right after Hurricane Sandy, and now we know it's kind of part of our everyday life. So what I've put together is kind of a quick update on the past year, and hopefully we'll be able to keep doing this. I would hope that everyone, to start off, is following us on social media. We are on Facebook, we are on Twitter, we are on Instagram. So if you're not, the handle is West Orange Info, so that's facebook.com/WestOrangeInfo, Twitter, and Instagram/WestOrangeInfo. So if you're not following, make sure you do. So again, 3 years ago, social media was not really a big thing here. Over those past 3 years, our audience has grown, groups have been created, neighborhood groups, individual community groups, moms, dads, everything in between. This past year, officially, West Orange posted over 1,000 times. We posted over 400 pictures, over 60 videos, and made the community aware of over 200 events. Why is this important? Obviously, it's keeping the community updated on the happenings, both the good, the bad, where to go, where to stay away from, like car accidents on Northfield. And where to go, like Restaurant Week and the Christmas tree lighting. Specifically, when we start digging into the individual platforms, Facebook, we're seeing about 50,000 impressions monthly on the postings that we're doing. We're just about at 10,000 likes. When we started, we were just under 2,000, so that continues to grow. On Twitter, 45,000 monthly impressions of our postings and over 2,000 followers. And Instagram, that didn't exist when we started, we're over 1,400 followers and growing. So I look at social media at the end of the year as a way to recap some of the great things that we did throughout the year. And we're actually in the process of putting together kind of a highlights reel, if you will. So if I may, kind of talk about some of the things that we covered and made happen in social media this year. after that crazy blizzard that we had at the top of the year. One of our local residents posted an amazing picture of Eagle Rock Reservation. We reposted it, over 1,000 likes, and shared 100 times. Obviously, that Slide the City event we had, we posted a video that was viewed over 70,000 times and reached 250,000 people. West Orange student Marley Diaz appeared on Ellen DeGeneres. It was liked 650 times and shared over 275 times. Obviously, social media is not always good. At the beginning of the year, we had the St. Mark's Church fire. Historian Joseph Fagan put together a tribute video that was viewed over 50,000 times. We obviously celebrated Scott Kelly's return from space and then live streamed the ceremony here on the front steps of Town Hall, viewed over 70,000 times. Local stories like our fire police, specifically West Orange police officers wearing body cameras, reached over 25,000 people, that posting. Social media is a great time to celebrate history of our town as well. When we posted about Thomas Edison completing the world's first movie studio here on Main Street, that was liked over 500 times. This past year we did ride-alongs. Specifically, I spent some time riding along with our police department, and after that 30-inch snowstorm, rode with the Department of Public Works and created videos that were viewed over 50,000 times. Obviously, the community loves posts about our diversity and acceptance of all shapes, sizes, colors, religions, and sexual preferences. We ran contests throughout the year, including one around Father's Day with City Workshop that was liked over 2,000 times for an entry to win a gift card. Community went crazy when our hometown hero Kyrie Irving hit the game-winning three-pointer and liked our posting 400 times. We even experimented a little with drone photography and video, capturing the 4th of July festivities, and that video was viewed over 5,000 times. One platform I didn't talk about that we experimented with this year was Snapchat. We created our first ever Snapchat geofilters around the St. Patrick's Day Parade, and then again around Slide the City. These filters were viewed over 100,000 times for their usage. And again, this is not my normal look with the mustache, but we use social media to raise awareness for our annual West Orange Movember campaign, which this year will hit an all-time high for our annual campaign. We are over $12,000 already, and as a community have raised over $40,000 for men's health. And there's still time to donate. We are at westorange.org/Movember. This past year, we created a lot of cross-promotional synergies with the Chamber of Commerce, the Downtown Alliance, and the public school systems. We used social media to help get the word out about missing persons, road closures, power outages, and the availability of cooling centers. We post regularly about West Orange jitney delays, and we even make sure that the text alerts that are sent out to over 800 people are sent in a timely fashion. We posted when we reached a new membership milestone at the Ginny Dunkel Pool this summer. We post videos about our parks, our downtown, our businesses, and just recently posted a very powerful video about our Human Relations Commission that, if you haven't seen, please spend some time. That has been viewed over 5,000 times in just a few weeks. This year, we made sure everyone was registered to vote and knew their proper polling locations, and regularly promote our West Orange property tax program to promote specific businesses and services. Again, we make sure the community knows about all of our events, including things like Restaurant Week, Small Business Saturday, the Holiday Open House, Christmas and Christmas Tree Menorah Lightings. And our social media presence, while very active in West Orange, extends past West Orange, not only to neighboring towns and states, but we have a lot of activity from countries as far away as India, Brazil, and the UK. Our diversity of our township shines bright when we look at the languages that people consume our content in. Past English, we look at Spanish, Portuguese, French, Arabic, Italian, German, and many more. And for those of you who are wondering, our profiles are the busiest in the afternoon and early evening hours, which is when people are commuting, finishing dinner, or putting their kids to sleep. So we're excited to continue. That's just, again, a few of the highlights. We're putting a highlight reel together that will be posted via social media, of course, to kind of capture a lot of what we have done and what we hope to do in the new year. The consistency throughout all of these postings is something that we are trying to push more, is around these hashtags. And the hashtags help you find postings and help you come together. The one that we have been using consistently is this We Are West Orange hashtag. There's a bunch of them in the mix, the Downtown West Orange, West Orange, New Jersey, but the We Are West Orange is really starting to catch on. And I think it speaks volumes to what we are. So again, I encourage everyone to follow our profiles, and when posting, use one of those hashtags to show people who we are, what we are. So thank you. If there's any questions?
Any questions, our members? Yes.
Thank you. First of all, great job.
Thank you.
Been following you all year. Is it possible that you could work this year more with the Recreation Department? I know, like, for example, Cheryl Marklinger from the PAL, she's doing an awesome job.
Yep.
She really boosts the numbers at the PAL. I see Mountaintop starting to utilize social media more. And I think with our younger, you know, with our parents and with our youth programs, that's a great vehicle to get the signups out to them, especially now that a lot of it's not being carried home in the book bags anymore. So
yeah.
If there's any way we could coordinate with Billy Keough.
Absolutely.
I know we have our newly formed, I won't spoil the surprise, our lacrosse club members are here tonight.
Yeah,
to boost enrollment throughout all our youth programs.
Yeah,
we've
spoken with Bill a few times. We post the recreational newsletter and link whenever possible to the events, but agree that there's much more that we can do with recreation. My group also manages Mountaintop League. We work with Cheryl on PAL as well. I think the beauty of social media is bringing everything together, right? So I'd love to add recreation and everyone else to those opportunities for cross synergy. So yeah.
And I know I saw you also had some of our programs out there with the health department, with our senior services as
Absolutely.
Well.
Absolutely.
So
yeah.
If we could see some more of that, that'd be great.
Absolutely.
But other than that, great job, Perry. Thank you.
Yes, Councilman Guarino?
Yes, Perry, thank you. Great job, especially working with our youth, you know, with Mountaintop League and PAL. I mean, it's really boosted the attendance, the registration, and the image of both programs. So thank you. It's been great. Just a real question. Do you have any goal for updating the Welcome to West Orange, you know, video or anything on our website to show more up-to-date things that are happening? And
yeah, absolutely. We've been speaking a lot about utilizing, you know, the live components of all of these social platforms, Facebook Live, etc. And we have started shooting some interview footage and capturing these quick snippets, right? Because obviously, when you look at the data, people are watching these short video clips. So we've done a lot of those. We've been experimenting, seeing what people are liking. I think this human relations video is the first of those that you'll see start coming out, because it is time to update the Welcome to West Orange. There's a lot happening, but trying to do them in snippets so we have people coming back regularly, looking for more content, sharing those short videos. And something that's big now that people probably see are videos without speaking, right? When you're commuting, when you're in a meeting, when you're doing things, you're able to actually watch, and there's text. Maybe a soundtrack behind it. So we're utilizing that. We've done a bunch of those for the schools. We've done a bunch of them for the town. So we'll be doing a lot more of those in the new year.
Sure. And the last thing, have you been reaching out, or have some of our other organizations been reaching out to you, say, the Friends of the Thomas Edison, them, of course, and the Friends of the Library? Have they been reaching out to you to do more exposure for them?
So I proactively reached out to a lot of folks to make sure that I was on all of the distribution lists. But yes, when there's special things, or maybe even we get first looks, if you will, yes, absolutely. The Friends of the Library, Thomas Edison, Unico, a bunch of different organizations within town have reached out to make sure that we are posting specifically around the events that they're hosting. So we make sure that all of that is there. But yeah, all of that's on our radar for sure.
Thank you very much, Perry.
Thank
you. Good job.
Thank you, Perry. Councilwoman?
Well, I just want to say thank you also, because not only do you post those things, but I send you so many things, and that all gets posted too. So it's just to increase the awareness all around town. The few experiments that you just mentioned sound very successful. And is there anything out there in the field that you, besides making the memory real, what else do you see as an experiment?
Yeah, it's a great question. You know, live is a big thing now. And it's not always a comfortable thing, mm-hmm. Because you can't redo it, right? So we are experimenting with the technology that continues to evolve. From check-ins to location-based type of things, so we will be very active with that. We have encouraged a lot of the organizations within town to take advantage of whatever's happening. These internet memes, right? This mannequin challenge going around now. There's a lot of the sports organizations that took advantage of it. Those things just kind of riding the wave of what's going on the internet never hurts. And I think that we've benefited from that many times doing those, like the ice bucket challenge a few years ago, right? Those types of things, having the mayor and others do that. So I think more of that, you'll see more of that. And I ask and I hope that people are open to some of them, even though some of them are silly. It kind of humanizes and brings to life some of our organizations, some of the people that are behind the scenes. So we'll be doing a lot of that. And facts and figures. People love facts and figures. They love to be able to become educated with quick snippet facts and figures. So we're building out a whole kind of programming schedule around that. And then we do have a lot more plans for this We Are West Orange campaign, which is not only promoting from within, but letting the folks in surrounding towns who may be looking to move out of the city know where they're welcome. So yeah.
Sounds like an excellent idea for economic development also.
Absolutely. Marketing. So always open to any suggestions and love to brainstorm on these types of things.
Thanks, Perry.
Thank you. Councilwoman, 2 points. We have two of the most important services for any community. We have public safety, and I see two of our police officers here, Cassidy and police officer Jasper, joining us. Public safety and our public schools. Does our public school Board of Education have a separate social media initiative? And yeah, do you work together with them to promote the quality?
We do that as well. So we do both. We do the town and we do the schools.
Oh, okay, I see.
So we've seen a large increase in both by being able to cross promote, mm-hmm. right? And I think that is key, right? The mm-hmm. same with the downtown, the same with the chamber. And quite honestly, anyone else that tags and cross promotes and talks to each other via social, which is really what it's all about. So we've been pretty active with them as well.
Terrific. Thank you, Perry.
And can I just also comment?
Yeah,
the police department has been great, providing a lot of pictures, community awareness type stuff. That obviously a huge topic, in news, media, social, et cetera. So any time that we are able to promote the positive of our police department, our fire department, or anyone, we take advantage of that, right? Whether it's the coffee with a cop, just pictures at the mayor's 5K, or taking silly pictures, Master Chef, taking silly pictures with me with mustaches. It's all very beneficial, obviously, and just shows the amazing community in the police department that we have.
Well, thank you, and yeah, it really helps us. You know, I work in different communities, and I know people of all over the state, and they tend to really not know about West Orange much. So I'm glad that we take an initiative to promote it and get the word out about how beautiful the community is. I know that, you know, sometimes we get mixed in terms of, the surrounding communities and our neighbors, and people have a different perception of our community. And then when they come and visit, they're like, oh my God, this is different than what I thought.
I will say it's been quite interesting this year. I've seen more than ever surrounding communities liking, sharing our postings. Right, great. Which we were seeing a lot of us doing, but we're starting to see surrounding towns liking, commenting, and sharing on the postings that we're making. So good. Hopefully we're doing something right.
Councilman Kukovia.
Yeah, just wanted to ask about the funding for the videos. I don't recall that you had done a lot of videos up until this point.
Yeah.
Is that being funded out of the, I think it's $2,000 a month fee?
Yes, it is.
It is. Okay, thank you.
Thank you, Councilor. Okay, Perry, thank you again.
Thank you very much.
For being here with us.
Thank you.
Council President?
Yes, Council?
I just want to alert and remind you that we have an executive session on tonight, and there are two potential participants by phone who are only available during the next 10 or 15 minutes.
Oh, okay. So we have to get the public meeting started shortly. So maybe we ask, we're going to do redevelopment. Maybe if you're willing, we can merge council liaison announcements, your remarks after public meeting again, just for the,
sure,
because we have this situation.
It sounds good.
That's fine.
Yeah,
it's fine.
Okay, so we'll do a short a briefing on redevelopment, on where we are at this stage, and then we're going to move on, close the meeting, and start a public session.
I've been visiting the site at least once a week, sometimes twice a week. Where we're at now is the garage is fully erected outside. Now they're working on the inside, putting in filming and electrical work. We're trying to finish that up. The architects are working on the footings for the ROR, which is, as you can see, if you go by there, you'll see that's already being done. They're working diligently with the Historic Preservation Commission to work on the facade. I was on the phone with them last week, and that seems to be moving along pretty well, and I think by next week that should be resolved. And what they're also doing is, if you notice in the battery building, they now have gutted the whole building, and now they're starting to work on the inside of that building, basically bringing in electric, plumbing, and they're studying it. And they're starting to work on the, the penthouse suites, suites up on the top. That's where they're going to start working on it. So far, it's moving along pretty well.
Just two quick questions, Mr. Sayers, on my behalf. Number one, financially, are they still working within their financing? The township has not been asked yet to make any contributions to that project. Terrific. And number two, aesthetically speaking, received a lot of comments about the garage going up, and it looks boxy. However, it's my understanding that there is a commercial component around it that'll change the aesthetic look to what it is now, from what it is now.
If you come down Main Street, you'll see the footings are in on the right-hand side for the ROR. That's going to cover basically.
Okay, and one more point, and I'm sorry, and I'll yield. I've had some entities that are interested in coming in, some franchises that are interested in the commercial component and in the commercials area. Who should they contact?
Chamber of Commerce? Daytown. Project manager, so I can find out. I'd love to talk to them.
Mr. Terrell?
I would love
to. Okay.
Thank you.
Steve Terrell is the gentleman that I deal with.
Okay. Thank you, Mr. Sayers. Councilwoman Castellino, yes.
Did you want to go first, or?
Sorry.
So once the facade is picked out, it's finalized with the Historic Preservation Group, will they be ready at a point, I would assume, to do a final rendering of the exterior of the project?
Well, right now they're working with the architect to redo the plans for the facade changes that they wanted. And from what I found out yesterday, I believe that's hopefully going to be done by the end of next week.
Because the last time I was there on site, they said they didn't post the final picture of the project because they didn't have the final plan done. Okay, and then once we get that, we'll be able to see a picture of it, and we'll be able to post it on the websites. Great. And then, one last thing, too. I was going to ask Perry when he was up there. Is there any way we could do one of those little videos down on the site to post as well as the project moves along?
Yeah, they were not big fans of us being there yet. We did do some drone stuff.
Okay.
As the building will go down, but we are still talking to them as it continues to come together.
Yeah. Okay, great.
Thank you, Councilwoman. Councilwoman?
Thank you. So, Jack, Victor, to your point with the, I know people have posted that it looks like a bunker, and it does look like a bunker right now. But there is 18,000 square feet of retail space to be built out. So what, I guess to the point about the rendering, since we're having the holiday tours coming up on December 3rd, we're hoping that those renderings could be done and an large rendering be posted out there on the fence so that people are on Main Street, they'll be able to see what it's supposed to look like as opposed to posting what they think it is.
I think what we need to do is, like I said, if I can get the final plans by the end of next week, which they're, I talked to Marty Feikowitz and Brian Feeney, as well as people from the redevelopers, and they're finalizing that plan, and hopefully that's going to be finalized by next week. So once that's finalized,
yeah, I don't think it'll be ready for the third.
Yeah, I don't know if it'll be ready for the third, because once they finalize it, then it has to be approved by Tom Trace. So I'm not sure if it would be ready by the third. You know, I'm not going to tell you it is.
Right.
I'm not so sure it would be. But it'll be ready. It could be ready maybe if they come up with the agreement, probably by the first week in December, maybe.
Okay.
Thank you.
Just a couple of quick questions. As far as you understand, the construction is on schedule?
Yeah.
Okay. Is there anything new on the impending foreclosure on the 217 Main Street,
not
the CVS property?
Not that I'm aware of. I mean, I think it was scheduled for the 29th of November, if I'm not mistaken. Mm-hmm. But I haven't heard anything new. Since we won't get anything until after it's happens.
Okay. Thank you.
Okay.
Thank you, Councilman. Anyone else? Madam Clerk? Yeah.
This is to inform the general public that this meeting is being held in compliance with Section 5 of the Open Public Meetings Act, Chapter 231, Public Law 1975. A notice of this meeting was emailed to the Star Ledger and the West Orange Chronicle on October 14, 2015. A notice of this meeting was also posted on the bulletin board in the Municipal Building, West Orange, and filed in the office of the Municipal Clerk of the Township of West Orange on October 14, 2015. Councilwoman Castellino?
Present.
Councilman Guarino?
Present.
Councilman Krakowiak?
Present.
Councilwoman McCartney?
Present.
Council President Cirillo?
Present. Thank you, Madam Clerk.
We're going to go into executive session.
Are we doing the Pledge of Allegiance again? We did it earlier. Okay. So, we had a special visit by the Honor Guard, the Fire Department Honor Guard, during the promotional ceremony. So we are moving on to the next item on the agenda. At this point, I am going to consider a motion to bring up 255-16, resolution authorizing an executive session for the purposes of discussing litigation.
So moved.
Second.
Okay. Councilwoman Castellino?
Yes.
Councilman Guarino?
Yes.
Councilman Krakowiak?
Yes.
Councilwoman McCartney?
Yes.
Council President Cirillo?
Yes. Thank you, Madam Clerk. Members of the public, we'll be right back. We have a matter that needs to be discussed at this point in the meeting. And when we come back, we're going to move on to a public comment. So just hang tight. Okay, we're back in session. Thank you for your patience. We're going to get started with the public comment portion of tonight's meeting. We have Lillian and Bill.
Yes, I'm Leanna Teresa.
Leanne, I'm sorry.
Dix Volpe, and I'm with Bill Sullivan. I am a 20-year resident of West Orange. I have my older son has just started NJIT for engineering. I have a son at Liberty Middle School, and I'm very happy to say this will be my eighth year as a lacrosse parent. After many, many months, a bunch of dedicated lacrosse parents have finally got together, and we are proud to announce the formation of the West Orange Lacrosse Foundation, known as WOLF. We have created a mission statement, which is to grow the elite emerging sport of lacrosse in our wonderfully diverse community of West Orange. We think that makes our town very, very special. Other towns are not as diverse as we are. We are a 501(c) foundation, and we are an approved parent booster club with the Recreation Department. We have worked very, very hard for many months with the Recreation Department very closely, and we want to share this wonderful announcement. And the great news is we have a girls lacrosse team in our future for the high school. We are growing the girls sport. We have 3-4. We're starting 5-6. In another 2 or 3 years, we will be a force in the high school with a girls team. So I have a newsletter we'd like to share. We've started fundraising throughout the community, and now I'd like Bill to, who is our co-president and treasurer.
I get all the good jobs. Hi, thank you. First, I want to acknowledge Michelle because Michelle did this for a long time at the high school when her son was playing at the high school. And I think what we're trying to do now is to extend the great efforts that you did with, as a booster at the high school down into the lower levels. Because lacrosse, like any other sport, we've got to get these guys started and playing and these girls started and playing in first and second grade. When we go out to these tournaments in Morris County, these kids have all been playing since kindergarten and first grade. And so we're trying now to extend that into the lower to the lower levels, the lower grades. My son's been playing 4 years. I never knew anything about lacrosse until 4 years ago. We really enjoyed it. We do have a great group of parents who are behind this now. And so what we're trying to do now is through the organization is to promote awareness of the sport, to encourage participation, and also to do some fundraising to supplement the great efforts that that Kehoe is doing through the rec department to also raise money from the business community to improve the quality of the uniforms that we have. That's really our objective for this year, but also hopefully eventually get to the point where we've got nice tents. When you would go and do these tournaments with these towns from Morris County, everything is first class, and we want to be first class too. And so that's the effort that we're undertaking now. And we are going to be, I want you all to know about this, because we are going to start go out to the business community and start handing out these really nice packets that Leanna and the group have prepared and ask them to help support us in our efforts this year with getting new uniforms. So that's where we are.
Thank you, Bill. If any parent is interested in joining the club, Leanne, who do they call? How do we get in touch with you?
Well, we have a Facebook page, West Orange Wolves, and the Facebook, West Orange Wolves. Sure. We have a newsletter that we've been handing out, and I will be putting it in stores. And the rec department will also be publishing our newsletter.
And we have a special event coming up February 8th.
Yes, and I'm very, very grateful that the recreation department has given us the CAT Center every second Wednesday of the month forever. And we have already started our monthly meetings there. We're using it as a venue for fundraising. We have a regular monthly meeting there, and everyone is welcome.
I guess the other thing I would say, especially with the television, is that if you have a child who's a first or second grader, this is a spring sport. So if they're not playing baseball, this is a chance for them to be active in the spring in a really great sport, girls and boys. So we encourage people to get out and get their kids interested. It's a little tough the first year, but once they figure out how to pick the ball up, it takes about a year to do that. Then they get pretty good and they have a lot of fun. So I encourage parents to get their kids interested. Thanks. Great.
Thank you both.
Thank you.
Good job.
That's great.
You're next. I just show you how it
is. Wow, we got the Holy Bible up here.
We have several Bibles up there,
right? Ashley was baptized at St. Joe's and confirmed. Then I bailed on them. So I'm Megan Brill with the Downtown West Orange Alliance. We have a lot of stuff going on, and people, Perry mentioned a few things. We have Small Business Saturday, which is kicking off the Saturday after Thanksgiving. This year we have 50 to 75 different businesses that are all providing something throughout the township. What I think is unique about this year's group of businesses is that
Dr. Left, who's in the valley, I would say Dr. Left is the dentist that's on the right in the valley. And he's offering a Zoom cleaning for only $350. It's like at least a $495, you know, value. But I've been trying since I got here to get Dr. Left to do something with us. He's one of the longest businesses in the valley. And I mailed him a letter, snail mail, and his secretary called me back. And they're in, so I'm excited about that. So we have folks down in the valley, all the way across to the Eagle Rock section of town, and all over West Orange. You'll see balloons and banners and hearts in windows, and we're pushing out a whole bunch of lists and little videos that talk about, you know, what kind of offer in any one of the businesses that's happening. The day after Small Business Saturday kicks off Restaurant Week. We have an assortment of restaurants from old establishments that have been here for a very long time and brand new restaurants like Jersey Girl Cafe, which is up in Pleasantdale. We have Bonds. There's Safarat is the Turkish restaurant on the corner in Pleasantdale. They are changing their name. And so they're having a grand opening on Monday night. And they have all kinds of specials happening that entire week. In addition, we have, you know, 10 or 15 businesses in the middle of town. We have the Essex House and China Gourmet up in on Pleasant Valley Way. So there's a lot of assortment, and we have about 10 businesses downtown that are all participating in Restaurant Week. We have Oak Barrel that's doing a set menu with a lot of different offerings for one set price. And Benji's and Don Juan's and Folklore. So it's a good mix of the businesses that have been here for a while and brand new businesses. The Saturday after Small Business Saturday is the Holiday Open House. That is our traditional pictures of Santa Claus, and then it ends with the tree lighting here at Town Hall. We are doing the guided trolley ride through Thomas Edison National Historic Park and up into Glenmont and past the garage, and you go see Charles Edison's house and the Chubb House, which if you don't know what the Chubb House is, you gotta come on the ride and figure out what the Chubb House is. I know you know what the Chubb House is. So there's gonna be a whole list of things that is, again, will be posted out through social media. I have a few copies of a flyer. They were made on my printer though. The real flyers are coming tomorrow. So there's a list of everything that's going on that day. There'll be pictures with Santa Claus. The host place is going to be Washington Elementary School. So the trolley will pull into Washington, pick you up. It runs every half an hour from 11 o'clock to 3:30. It's hosted by the mayor and members of the town council. And it's free. We have free crafts for the kids inside Washington and pictures with our fabulous Santa. The one thing that I think you all were mentioning with the renderings of the redevelopment, if we don't have big pictures ready to go, if we could have a handout of what the rendering looks like for the trolley ride, that would be helpful.
Be real good.
And if you can get me a digital copy, I can make copies. Okay, so that would be helpful. I'll let them know. Okay, I think that is all that I had on my list. We've been very busy. Our budget hearing will be the second meeting in December, and you'll hear more about us then. If you don't have any questions.
Okay.
Sure, go ahead.
Yeah, just real quick, I have this for you, Ms. Burrell. So American Express, you get double reward points on Small Business Saturday, and that's nationwide. I did a little research, and you go on their link, and there's about 15 businesses in town that are signed up. Now, any one of them could sign up, so I don't know if you want to take this and email that to your list to get them signed up before Saturday, and residents could earn extra double points if they use their American Express card.
There's two ways that you can register with American Express. You can actually, and a few of our businesses have known that we do it, so they've actually gone and done it themselves. There's something called the Champion. I am a champion for the Small Business Saturday. So they gave us a whole bunch of stuff. So that's where the banners and the balloons and the little bags that they hand out. I'm not sure if everybody that's with them will get 2 points off on their American Express card.
Thank you, Megan.
But you still, there's definitely a benefit of just coming and shopping small. The point of Small Business Saturday is to support the mom and pop stores, mm-hmm. the non-chain. You know, they have Black Friday the day after Thanksgiving where you go to the mall and you spend all your money. Well, we're asking that you save a little bit of money to spend it in, you know, locally in your downtowns or in your small businesses.
Mayor.
Thank you.
You might also want to mention, though, that Small Business Saturday has been extended for the whole weekend because not everyone can shop on
Saturdays.
Right,
Saturday and Sunday.
So
yeah.
Nationwide.
Yeah, it actually ends up being, because of the holiday open house, and there's that week between, we thought that would just make the Small Business Saturday restaurant week and the holiday open house be an entire West Orange, you know, week. So pretty much every business is offering the discount that they give on Small Business Saturday through the whole week. Mm-hmm.
Great. Thank you.
Thanks, Meg.
Thank you.
Yeah,
Mr.
Sylvester.
Good evening. Claire Silvestri, 20 Grandview Avenue. The weather has turned really cold, and it's a good time to remind residents that from now through Wednesday, December 7th, the West Orange Girl Scouts are again collecting coats for the Jersey Cares coat drive. People can donate new or gently used coats of any style or size to the coat drive, and it's even easier this year to donate. That's because, thanks to our West Orange coordinator and troop leader from Redwood School, Shauna Roth, we have collection bins placed all over town. There's one here out in the lobby of Town Hall, as well as at West Orange Library, Redwood, Kelly, and Mount Pleasant Elementary Schools, Our Lady of Lourdes and St. Joseph's Churches, Weikert Realtors across from Essex Green on Prospect Avenue, and even in Montclair at B'nai Keshet Synagogue. Now the Girl Scouts will sort and bag the coats and then deliver them to Jersey Cares, where they will be distributed to those in need. Last year, through the generosity of West Orange residents, we collected close to 150 coats, and we're hoping for an even better result this year. So if anyone has questions about the coat drive, you can call me at 973-736-7285 or shoot me an email at Claire, C-L-A-R-E-S-K-3 at yahoo.com. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Silvestri. Yes.
Hi, Mariel Clemenson, 4 Cherrywood Circle in West Orange. I thought I might update you on what's going on in the financial markets in light of the election, because everything is completely different. And as far as municipal rates are concerned, you might be interested in knowing the following. First of all, personal and corporate income tax rates are likely to go down, and sharply. There's talk, as you probably know, of trillions of dollars in infrastructure spending in the United States to boost the economy. Interest rates have already moved higher in anticipation of what this is going to mean. And they've moved higher not only in personal mortgages, but also in Treasury bonds, U.S. Treasury bonds, and also in municipal bonds, about 50 basis points on the muni side, just so you know. Inflation's going to be higher. There's some debate about this, but it looks like it might, in fact, be a permanent move off of the low interest rate environment we've been in. So what does all this mean? Well, first of all, New Jersey State just got a downgrade to A- by Standard & Poor's due to some pension and budget issues. There's lots of talk in muni finance circles about difficulties that Illinois and Chicago are having in financing. Don't want to use the bankruptcy word because it doesn't really exist in munis, but they're getting close to that. There's 5 states, including New Jersey, that are kind of put on a watch list for financial problems in the future. Not like tomorrow, but down the road. Okay, what does this mean for West Orange? You might be interested in knowing that municipal bonds are now moving into a world of discomfort, as investors see their bond prices go lower and the rates are going higher. So the trouble in other cities and states could well mean that, you know, just to drill it down to something local here, that it's more important than ever. At some point, maybe not this year, but at some point, it's going to be very important for West Orange to, in order to maintain its AA rating, which I think it has, to prepare a balanced budget and one that can forecast and match the future needs of what we need on a projected basis and match that to what our expected future revenues are likely to be. We've never really done this because we don't really, we should do it because it's considered a best practice, but we really should start thinking about capital expenditures and forecasting that. We've talked about it a lot over the last few years, but we need to incorporate it in the budget and then match it up with what you think the likely revenue stream will be. Finally, I just have to say, unfortunately, I was distressed during the elections near the very end. Jerry, I'm sorry to have to point you out. Jerry, you reprinted an article from the West Orange Chronicle and changed the wording, and I thought that was misleading and actually unnecessary. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Clemenson. Yes, Ms. Morelli.
Rosemary Morelli, excuse me, Ralph Road. Tonight I have a couple of things I'm going to talk about. One is I just had a really interesting couple of days. I'm having my annual health exams with my geriatrician, my dermatologist, and my dentist. I have one more to go to. Anyway, the reason I'm mentioning this is every time I go into these doctors, it's routine with them, and they ask me what's happening in West Orange. I don't know why they ask me that question, but they do. Anyway, as usual, I brief them, and this time I brought them up to date on the issue of the Senior Citizens Advisory Board. What surprised me was that they all thanked me for what I'm doing. And the reason is they expressed their concern that seniors are being underserved and neglected. My thought is, who would know better than these professionals what's happening with the older people? I'm wondering if West Orange should be considered guilty because of the inaction of the mayor and four of the council people who are resisting starting a senior citizens advisory committee. I suggest you all take time out to think about it. Thanksgiving Day would be a very appropriate time. The other is the issue of Mr. Guarino's misuse and edit of the West Orange Chronicle's Chronicle endorsement. In a follow-up editorial, the Chronicle described it as a hatchet job and that Mr. Guarino's campaign removed several mentions of Councilman Krakowiak's name from the headline and three internal paragraphs touting Krakowiak. They go on to say, quote, actually editing the document and attempting completely remove someone is very different and is completely unethical. Not only did Guarino not ask our permission to reprint the editorial, which we own, making his actions illegal, and so on and so on and so on. I guess you've all read the article. It's my opinion Mr. Guarino should apologize to Mr. Krakowiak and to the citizens of our township for his indiscretion. I would also like Councilwoman Castellino a question. Her name and photo was also on the flyer. Why would she approve of such an action? In my opinion, she should also offer an apology. I'm going to wait for them both to reply. And I want to say this is not the West Orange that I know. Since 1963 being in this town, this is a disgrace and an embarrassment.
Thank you, Ms. Morelli. Anyone else from the public? Anthony?
My name before I raise my hand.
It was a question.
You're a fixture, Anthony.
Hi, Anthony Puglisi, representing County Executive Joe DiVincenzo. We have a wide range of holiday activities that are already started at Turtleback Zoo. The Holiday Light Spectacular began last Friday, and I'm proud to say that this first opening weekend, this is the first time we've opened this early, we had over 7,000 people come this weekend. So it continues again the weekend after Thanksgiving, and then the weekend after that, and then beginning December 9th to January 2nd, it's open every night of the week from 5 to 9. All we ask is, it's a free event, all we ask is that people bring either a non-perishable food item, gently used coat, sorry, I'm in competition, but it's all for a good cause, or a new unwrapped toy. Last year we collected over 25 tons of material, with a lot of the food going to the community food bank, and then a variety of local organizations got the other stuff. December 3rd is our holiday house tour, which includes Glenmont as one of its stops. In all, there's 15 historical homes or locations that are participating. At our environmental center, December 1st is the deadline to register for our Sustainable Homes and Habitats Gingerbread Contest. And our contest is a little different in that we ask people to learn about the environment by creating gingerbread houses that have solar panels or rain barrels or...
Five features.
Yeah.
Five features.
Yes. So that's always good because you can see the creativity of the people who enter. It also makes me very hungry because I have a very big sweet tooth. And then up at Kipps Castle, we have a number of things. During the month of December, the castle will be open Wednesdays to Sundays, with the first floor being decorated in the 1920s era. And then on select days throughout the month, we'll have candlelight tours where you can learn about the history of the castle as well as see the Tiffany windows in a new light, candlelight. Nice. All that information is on our website, which is EssexCountyNJ.org. And we hope to see you at all of those events. Thank you.
Very nice. And before you go, Council President?
Yeah, please.
I have just a question. Thank you for all of that information. Just like Perry was here before, we always share and mm-hmm. send all your information out. But I had a question about Strider Lights. The Strider Lights are on Cherry Lane, Pleasant Valley Way, for deer, controlling deer.
Yes.
And I wanted to just take a note back to the county about the lights being used on Prospect Avenue. Because between the golf course and Seton Hall and the Antioch Church there, there are so many deer in the road. That I think it should be extended, not just Cherry Lane, but also on Prospect Avenue.
Okay, I'll have our take. We generally put those in areas where it's not residential, because some of the lights do emit a sound. So when the headlights hit it, it's a high pitched noise that does keep the deer from.
It's pretty much right by the golf course, though.
But if it's, we'll look to see if there's no residences along that. I don't think there are many.
Well, they're very deep lots, and they're more on Ridge Road, so they don't face Prospect.
Right.
But
we can take a look at it.
I appreciate it. Good. Mm-hmm. Thank you. Sure.
I have just a quick question, not related to the events going up or going out. The if some businesses want to get together and they want to change some of the parking regulations on, like, let's say, a Bloomfield Avenue or a Pleasant Valley Way so that it's more friendly to that specific business sector, who should we talk to and present a proposal to?
Parking is you.
Yeah.
Parking is municipal. If you want to change or add traffic lights or traffic patterns, then you need to do a warrant study. And then that warrant study is presented to our engineering department, and then they would either approve or agree or disagree with that. But parking is
so we should start
municipal.
Locally.
Yes.
Okay. Very good. Thank you, Anthony.
You're welcome.
I see other members of the public. Anyone have anything in mind that they want to share with the members of the town council? Well, seeing none, Madam Clerk, we're closing the public comment portion. Well, before we ask our my colleagues to answer or make any remarks in response. Who would like
May
to go
I?
First?
Sure.
Okay.
I can start.
See, I just want a lot of announcements there.
No. I was responding to
the designation, the banquet you attended, and the environment.
Oh, Sustainable Jersey. Okay.
Yeah. New Jersey Sustainable Communities.
I was going to start by thanking people that just came up to speak, particularly Claire with the coat drive, because we've been involved in scouting for a very long time. And the fact that we did have Perry here just a little while ago, if there is a flyer, Shauna Roth happens to be one of the moms from my school. So as soon as I saw the information, we sent that out. But that definitely can go out on the website if you can get a flyer to Karen. Okay, that's one. Keep up the good work. And Marielle, it sounds like you're ready for that budget season. So fast approaching. You said we don't do it, but we certainly try to match the projection to the revenue. It's not always possible. We try to do the best we can. And Mrs. Morelli, with the seniors, I guess if nothing is in place at this particular moment, the fact that you're here at every council meeting, if there is something, I know you want educational outreach, there's any kind of seminar, all you have to do is bring it to our attention and we will put it in place. I'm sorry to hear that doctors don't think that we're doing enough for our seniors. And I'm sorry I never found that article about how West Orange was considered one of the top 10 places to retire because of all the doctors and services in town for seniors. I'll have to find that and post it again. But truthfully, if there's anything that's not in place that you need to see in place, I know my colleagues, we would all be receptive, and the health department and the administration to put in place.
Thank you.
You wanted to talk about Sustainable Jersey? Just quickly, back in September, our certification for this Sustainable Jersey program that we got involved in back in 2007 when it came out, I became the coordinator, and I just recently sent out a thank you to every department here and Downtown Alliance and the Chamber. I really, to the police department, we have so many points. This is a program where you have to accrue points for putting sustainable elements in place, and the township has been so forward thinking way before 2007, before this started. So I'm just pleased that we were recognized as a community, and we do so many things in that direction. So thank you. But just also, I did go to the League. I'm sorry I didn't see you there, but we went to the League of Municipalities convention last week. But before I left, I just want to let everyone know that there was a New Jersey DOT, Department of Transportation grant for alternative transportation. An $827,000 grant was submitted thanks to working round the clock with Lenny and our grant writers. Scott's Miracle-Gro, there's a $40,000 grant. We just, before I left, had to press send before I left for the convention, a $40,000 grant with the Open Space Commission to look at 577 Mount Pleasant Avenue with the Rock, Gardens at the Rock up there. Congratulations to the to Joe Fagan. There was a historical marker grant that I passed along in his direction, and he was awarded, thanks to the county, he was awarded that to continue the historical marker program that he began. And we just submitted in time Everybody Walks grant, looking at a path around Vincent's Pond at Degnan Field. So there's one, there's a grant coming up, it's pending right now. This is from the Environmental Endowment. I don't have the amount here, but also working with Open Space. That's all I have.
Thank you, Councilwoman. And I chuckled because you're one of the hardest working people that I've ever met on behalf of a resident. I mean, grant after grant, we get emails every day about initiatives that you're working on. But I don't want to hijack the meeting. I do want to make some remarks in response. Bill Sullivan, good luck. When you were up there, it reminded me of the youth hockey initiative. Mm-hmm. It's a similar mm-hmm. Beginning. And I want to wish you luck and make sure we're on your list in terms of donations and let us know how we can be of help. I like the excitement. So thank you for coming up and presenting that to us and for your hard work and best of luck with everything. Is it an approved 501c3 at this point? Okay, terrific. So you'll be hearing more from the lacrosse club in the incoming future. Ms. Clemenson, thank you for bringing that important financial information. It does affect the markets, and we have to keep an eye on that. We are AA rating in West Orange?
Yes, and we just, this year we just sold a $17 million bond. And so we went from short to long at a rate of 1.78. So we got in under the mark. We were looking for the rates to increase. So we knew we were going to go long this year. So
thank you, Mr. Gross.
Personal mortgage.
And in Sustainable Jersey, it's a highly sought designation by municipalities, and the police department has done a tremendous job with Operation Hope, and that's something that we're going to score a lot of points on for next year. And again, it's a partnership. You guys are working so hard, and you're working with the organization to make sure that we get that recognition as a community that we richly deserve. Speaking of legal municipalities, I do want to make mention that our council had a great presentation on procurement and contract management. Mr. Trank was one of the presenters at the league, and he was very effective. You can hear you from down the hallway, from one end to the other, talking about what's a responsible bid. I learned a lot at your session. Thank you. And Ms. Borelli, let's stay in touch. It's a work in progress, please. Okay? You have my commitment. Let's keep talking, and we'll see what we can figure out. So with that said, I'm going to yield the floor to the next council person that wishes to speak. Councilman Kukowiak.
Thank you. Just want to say thank you to everyone for coming up. And just to follow up on Ms. Clemenson's comments, about interest rates going up, we're actually being asked to consider putting on an additional $600,000 in debt tonight, which would put us over $80 million, according to the supplemental debt statement. I'm very glad to hear about refinancing part of the debt, and I would be interested in getting more details about where things stand. I know you'll be doing that for the year end. But we had about $34 million in short-term debt outstanding, I guess, as of January. But I suppose a lot of that's been cleared off. But that was very good to refinance before the rates went up. But it's something that we do need to keep an eye on because our debt service and our outstanding debt issued and authorized has been going up considerably over the last several years.
Thank you, Councilman, and thank you for bringing that issue up constantly, that ratio, got to keep an eye on. That's a distinction between what debt versus the size of the budget.
Debt as based on the assessed value.
Based on assessed value. Okay. So just so everyone knows, the state of New Jersey has an expectation as to where that number should be, and councilmen and members of the council, we continue to keep an eye out on that as we go into budget season. So. I know that you made a presentation last year, and hopefully we'll do the same so that we can talk about where we are. We're not putting expenses on a credit card anymore as much as we have to.
Right.
Councilwoman Castellino?
Yeah, and Ms. Clemson, great timing. I had a long conversation with Mr. Gross today in regards to some capital improvements and in regards to our facilities and whatnot. The rates will be creeping up since the election. I'm a title closer, so I've been out closing loans like a crazy woman for my company. And the state, and according to what council president said, the state looks us to be at 3.5% debt ratio. I know last month we were at 1.33%, so we're still way under the threshold, which is a good thing. And we'll, you know, take that into consideration. But Mr. Gross, great job you've been doing trying to make us more efficient, refinancing our debt, and just even putting, you know, more efficient practices in place. So great job there. Let's see here. Ms. Brill, again, thank you for coming down. You've been very busy. Also, we forgot about our marker ceremony at 12 o'clock next Saturday, on Small Business Saturday at 12 o'clock at 80 Main Street. Joe Fagan will be presenting one of his markers right down the street here, or right across the street, at 12 o'clock p.m. So if you are shopping downtown or uptown, come down to 80 Main Street at 12 o'clock. So we forgot all about that. And remind me tomorrow, we'll talk. I was wondering if there's an app, Ms. Brill, in regards to like Restaurant Week, if we could get that information on the app that folks could just go to an app to get all the restaurants that are on there. Okay, cool. West Orange Unico had a meeting last week, a proud member of Unico, and they're having a toy drive as well. So a lot of goodwill in the township. And thank you, Mrs. Krakowiak, for the code drive information. Unico will be collecting new unwrapped gifts for children, and they'll be collecting them up until December 15th. And you could drop off your donations right at Eagle Bank at 641 Eagle Rock Avenue in West Orange. So they're looking for gifts for 5 and 6 year olds. Up to 11-year-old girls and boys, so whatever we could get there. And congratulations to Bill Sullivan, and I'm sorry Leanne had left, because I really like to congratulate her, working with her for the 4 years, well, a couple years at the high school. She's just a bundle of energy, and I'm so glad you're able to put this rec league, this booster club together, because it's definitely well needed in the township. Being a booster parent for 4 years at the high school level, just as hockey, lacrosse is an expensive sport for our students, but it's a great sport. Our students get a lot of scholarships, and especially for the girls lacrosse, a lot of great scholarships go out for lacrosse players as well as all the other sports, but it's an up and growing sport here in West Orange. We have a very energetic high school coach, Mr. Pete Turian, who is also a teacher for us at Roosevelt, and he's been working with you all at the recreation level. And that's what's been really helping our fall sports teams this year at the high school level really had great seasons. And that's because of the partnership we have with our recreation programs and working with our youth programs and building that relationships up. So our high school coaches come down to the rec level. They spend a lot of time with the coaches there and the kids learning the systems, and it's just been great effort by you all. So it's great to see now lacrosse, and you're in great shape with what you're doing, but it is expensive, so I'm glad you're able to move forward with the fundraising. And let's see, Ms. Morelli, you'd be glad to know I spoke with our grant writer just this week. She's back from the League of Municipalities, and as promised, she is working with the Partners in Health grant to move forward to hopefully get that grant for us, so we could get that Montclair State study for aging in place, as Montclair had done. So I'm looking forward to that. I hope we're a good candidate, which they think we are. And I think that will open up future conversations for this subject matter, which I think will make everyone happy. And anytime, as Councilwoman McCartney had said, any social, any events that you may want to have, or get it to Mr. Bashkoff on social media, because I know a lot of seniors are on social media. I know my mother's much better at it than I am. And we get a lot of things posted there, but I'm looking forward to some events. And I know this this summer at the pool with Officer Squires, you had some very good information events there, educating our seniors about fraud and some other issues. So, I mean, progress isn't stopping. You know, I know folks are disappointed that that committee didn't go through, but that doesn't mean, you know, services aren't stopping or we're not trying to add to them. So all good things. That's it. Thank you all for coming tonight.
Thank you for your hard work on the aging in place. That's great news.
Thanks.
Thank you. Councilman?
Thank you, Councilman. Thank you to my colleagues. Thank you all for coming out tonight. Mr. Sullivan, Bill, congratulations. It's a great sport. I'm glad to hear that it's moving forward. It'll add a great program to the high school and the middle schools. And I can just remember my grandfather when I was a kid asked me, why is everybody chasing everybody with a stick? I said, I'll explain to you another time, Grandpa. But that's besides the point. So good luck and whatever the council can do. We appreciate that. Megan, thank you for the great update on downtown. Again, about the marker for St. Mark's School that we really have to thank the Drill family, David Drill, who was one of our biggest sponsors and property owners in the Main Street corridor. He's very excited about having the marker there, so I hope everybody comes out and witnesses this another great move to West Orange's own Liberty Trail. So really great and really happy to hear about the holiday open house, Small Business Saturday, which is great. Talking to my friends at American Express, they're really rolling out the program, and every year it gets bigger and bigger. And notably, the stats here in West Orange, more of our vendors are taking, and merchants are taking American Express, so it makes it even better, a better program. Ms. Silvestri, thank you with the Girl Scouts. Is there a website or something where people, residents, could look online to find those drop-off points? Because I know you said it here, but if there's a place that residents can go on and look, that'd be really great, because I'm sure people will be looking to give out coats. Also, Restaurant Week, residents, please check out all the great restaurants in West Orange. We got some really hidden treasures and things you really need to check out. My thanks to the West Orange Police Department for its work. Just to let the residents know, if you didn't realize, that the county approved our ordinance to extend the school zone speed limit reductions that we had voted on a number of months ago, and now those speed zones have been approved by the County Board of Freeholders. So it's another step in our right direction. Another thing is Lori Kaffner, one of my board members on the Pedestrian Safety Advisory Board, and myself were awarded personal awards of appreciation and achievement from New Jersey Quick Transit for our work in making West Orange and our complete streets and making West Orange a more mobile community. So we're really happy about that. Mariel, thank you for the financial updates, the great news, and it's something that you need to get your hands around the budget with us and see things that maybe we don't see, and it's things that we need to look out for in this coming budget with the changing financial climate. And thank you again for everybody coming out today, and make sure to take advantage of Restaurant Week, the Holiday Open House, and Small Business Saturdays. Thank you, Council President.
Thank you, Councilman. That concludes our public comment period portion of the agenda. Madam Clerk, item number 3.
Okay, we're going to review the consent agenda. Approval of minutes of previous meeting, public minutes of October 26, 2016.
Consent.
Report of township officers, none. Reading of petitions and communications and bids, none. Bills, are there any questions on the bills?
Consent.
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 Resolutions, are any resolutions being pulled this evening?
Yeah. Madam Clerk, 245-16 needs to come off.
Okay, that is, hold on one moment. Okay, Jay.
And let's pull 239-16. Just to understand it better.
Okay, D.
Yeah.
Okay, any others?
I do have a question, Madam Clerk, on the snow plowing. That would be 254-16 for Mr. Trank, actually. Yes, Mr. Trank, this has to do with the lowest qualified bidder. Mm-hmm. The question is okay, in this situation, and this is like going back to the legal municipality session that you had, in this case, you have a low bidder who does not have sufficient equipment to fulfill the responsibilities requested. So they're given part of the, they're being extended the opportunity to plow a portion of the bid, right? And because of the equipment. So for the part that's left of the township, that's being awarded to another contractor. can the awardee, the municipality, negotiate the hourly rate if we're going to a second bidder in this situation? Okay, so you have a municipality, right? Municipality A, right? And then you bid out snowplow and services, right? For
yes,
municipality
sir.
A. Okay? You find that the lowest bidder cannot do the entire municipality because it's too big, right? Because they don't have enough equipment. Okay? So they're not qualified to do the entire town. So in this instance, we're considering giving the lowest bidder half of the town, right? And going to the second bidder for the other half of the town. There's no, there's a resolution here dealing with.
Yeah, but that's if they're available, right?
Actually, if I could just read an email from Mr. Lepore, I think this will clarify, because I sent him some questions. The township has 17 plow routes, excluding parking lots and walkways. This resolution will provide contracted snow plowing and salting services in 8 routes, while the township will supply personnel and equipment in the other 9 routes. Mr. Pelos, Mr. Solis, and I evaluate our equipment and personnel and decide where they will be best suited. Those are the routes plowed and salted with township personnel and equipment, and the others are contracted out. So they're not backups, they're just doing a selected area of the...
And the bid itself specified that there would be multiple awardees.
Right.
So we're not to go again, as we...
That's the question. Can we negotiate pricing after the bid has been submitted? That is the question.
We can't negotiate a bid ever.
Okay.
Bid's a bid.
And you can see Schedule A as being... The rate.
Right, because that was a question. I mean, the first American Asphalt is under $200, and everyone else is over $200. So, again, you answer my question. You can't negotiate hourly.
No snow this year.
Oh, yeah.
That will solve that problem.
This is like an LSAT question, right?
Fortunately, I saw some yesterday morning, so mm-hmm. I'm not quite sure that's the case.
Thank you, Mr. Trank. Any other resolution questions?
I just want to make a comment on A. With the TAP grant, I just want to thank our colleague, Councilwoman McCartney, because she really hustled to get that to meet the deadline with the grant writer. And I appreciate all the time you spent on that. So thank you. Great job.
Thanks. And Lenny and Ken.
There's a housekeeping item.
Councilman Corbia?
Thank you. I would like to pull Agenda Item Q, Resolution 252. It's the resolution approving various outstanding tax appeals. And also would like to pull Agenda Item S, which you just asked about, Resolution 254-16, authorize an award of contract for snow plowing. I just had a couple of questions, and I'm not sure whether I can get them. I was expecting Mr. Lepore to be here tonight. Oh, he is here. Is he here?
No.
No, okay. So I just wanted to pull in case I don't have sufficient information to vote.
Sure.
So
okay.
Those are the two I'd like to pull, please. I also just had some a few questions.
Go ahead, Councilor.
If now is the appropriate time.
Yes, please.
Okay. Thank you. While I was out knocking on doors before the election, several people said that they didn't like me using my laptop because it reflected in my eyeglasses and they didn't like it. So I've tried to do it with printed versions, except it's a mess.
This, yeah.
So please just bear with me. If I could, on the first question, on the first resolution, 236-16, I'm not going to vote against it, but I'm just trying to get a better feel for this. This is we are going to outsource the scheduling of extra duty police officers here in town. We're presenting it to do it on a short-term basis. And I'm just trying to get a better idea of how this will impact the police and maybe how it impacts our budget.
About 239.
Oh, I'm sorry.
239 was pulled.
239 has been pulled.
Okay.
Madam Clerk, if he has questions, I may have the same questions, so can we put it back in?
Yeah, we haven't done anything.
Okay. Yeah, all right. Okay. Go ahead, Councilman. Fine. Please continue, because I may have the same questions as Mr. Lepore comes in. And we had questions in that other resolution. Go ahead, Councilman.
Okay. So we're on 236 now.
236 is the tap grant.
We're on 239.
Let's go back to 3916.
Questions.
Again, I think I'll just, in future meetings, I'll just go back to my
laptop. Use your laptop, Councilman. I know.
Yeah, but I haven't prepared it. I thought I prepared the...
Well, we started by asking...
Yes.
We started by asking what kind of impact would this resolution have on our municipal budget?
Yes.
Hiring someone to administer
the
distribution of manpower.
Right. So it's going to be outsourcing the scheduling of our extra duty. And I'm
scheduling and payment.
Scheduling and payment.
Yes.
And what I'm trying to figure out is how this might impact the police officers, how it might impact our budget. So maybe we could just talk about how the municipality earns fees through the extra duty. I think there's a couple of different charges.
We receive a fee for every hour worked, as well as a fee for every car hour that's utilized. We will continue to, as long as we have expenses that rise to the level of those fees, we will continue to receive those fees.
Okay. So,
In terms of the cost of actually performing this, will be passed on to the users.
Okay. So, you sent me an email, very helpful, that said in 2015, the township earned a little over $120,000
correct
in fees for the extra duty. And then I asked you, and I think the fee that they're charging is 4% of hours?
It's $4.
$4, so it's about 6.5%, something like that. Okay.
On average. Yeah, we have a different rate schedule, so it's going to be $4 per hour.
Okay. And so if that happened in 2015, then we would be paying out about almost $85,000.
That's correct.
Okay, in the fees.
So
in essence, we're keeping the fee structure that we have, but we could be getting, if 2016 was like 2015, we'd get another $85,000.
We're not going to get that $85,000.
Right, but the people who use the extra duty officers, and I think they use it because we require them to use it.
Correct.
Depends.
Depends on the ABC establishments.
No.
That's that ABC, doesn't fall on the
utility companies.
Yes.
I mean,
right.
Again, construction. It's safety issues. But the home run, which is why I caught the CFO on this, is as everybody's talked about, the worst thing you can have is it's hard to keep ahead of the money. And especially if you have a small business, again, with all due respect, in these economic times, we have to pay the officers. We have to stand behind this. That's why we provide workers' comp and everything else. But God forbid, we've had issues. I've always, little tense with the CFO saying, no, don't call me up and tell me they owe you money, because the police are getting paid. So don't book a side job, and it's a whole logistical issue. So I think the police department and the CFO, from what I understand, have determined that this is a guaranteed way where we can never, and therefore the police, can never be caught short. Because this company is going to post $38,000?
That's correct.
$38,000 right. That will be a live escrow. And we can terminate this on 30 days notice, as I understand.
Yeah, I mean, right now, and look, eventually, once we get into this a few months, and if we're happy, and this is a brand new service, if we're happy with it, then we'll actually go out for a formal bid, because it's going to go over bid threshold once at some point in time. So we're going to have to establish. But we think it's prudent to first try it on a month-to-month basis, and see how we like the service and see whether it works for us.
Okay. And so what Mr. Drake is saying is essentially the escrow fund will pay the officers while the vendor is getting...
Yes. No, I believe the way it would work is if Joe or Sally Bender wants a side job, they'll make them pay in advance. They'll handle all that. That's the beauty.
They're going to facilitate it.
So the 38 is only if for whatever reason, that is an escrow. We're not touching that. It's all the vendor's problem. It's all, what's it called for them?
Extra duty solutions.
Look, it's all, I call up. I'm having a party at my house. I'm not. But I want an off-duty officer to just deal with police, you know, deal with safety out front or whatever the issue is. They're going to make you pay in advance. I'm sure they'll collect credit cards, they'll collect all the money, and they're not going to give me credit. They shouldn't.
For instance, they're going to, like PSE&G, they're not going to require them to do up front. So they're going to have credit customers, they're going to have cash customers. But it's their problem. It's not our problem.
Right,
if they don't
right.
collect, it's not our issue. And most importantly, we're compliant with, you know, local finance notice from 2000 that requires us to have money up front and not to pay for police officers out of budget and then reimburse the budget. Not allowed to do that.
Right. And the vendor would be paying the police for this extra duty.
The police will still be working for the township. They will forward the money to us to replenish the escrow if we use the escrow on a weekly basis. So we're going to have our cash flow. Our employees are always going to get paid and we're going to be in compliance.
So who receives the money that's paid for an officer? Entity?
They are going to bill
They'll bill and get the revenue and forward that to us.
And then they will send money to us.
Okay.
Checks are made payable still to the township.
What's it? No, the checks will be made to them.
Okay, so they get the money and then they remit it to
us. Yes, it's not our fee, okay. It's their fee.
So I was looking for potential efficiencies, and you said this will cut down on the amount of time that personnel time to manage this. But you said there won't be any direct hardware or software savings.
To say we're doing less work. To the extent that we have equipment that may be used elsewhere for other things, really not tangible to give you a number. Clearly we're gonna whatever equipment we have is gonna be used in other areas. So in that sense, yes, we're saving on the wear and tear of our equipment, but it's not negligible. I mean, it's not. I wouldn't promote it as a significant savings.
Mm-hmm. Okay, and then I was trying to see if that's going. If having this service would increase efficiencies with this Kronos time management software that I think we're in the process of implementing.
Kronos is going to increase efficiencies, and this will feed into it. Again, it's if we weren't going to the Kronos, it would be more efficient. There would be efficiencies.
But the two sides don't talk to each other. They're both proprietary.
Well, they may. We're just not there yet.
Okay.
We're the same thing with a lot of our vendors or third party vendors. We're looking at the possibility they may be able to talk directly to Kronos, so we take us out of the middle, or at least we can watch from the middle.
Okay.
That's at this point in time right now. The biggest thing is that we're not going to be managing it. Managing the accounting process, or certainly significantly reducing it.
But I would think that it has to be a real-time connection between the two, because you say that there's going to be a file that'll be downloaded and then uploaded to Kronos. That's not going to be real-time, and that wouldn't help to know whether the officers are available in that time period or not, right? It would have to be linked up.
I'm missing your...
All right. If Kronos keeps all the scheduling and all the time management, then that's what would tell you whether a police officer was available for extra duty or not.
Yeah, this system is going to work outside of that, and the officers themselves are going to let the Holt Halsey know when they're available, et cetera. It's really more, it's definitely going to be on the outside of it as of right now. Again, as we go into the future, after we get into it, we would not, even if they offered it right now, we would not attempt to merge that into the Kronos situation right now, because that's way too intense to try to do it all at once.
Okay. So. Great. Thank you. That's all the questions I had on 230.
Thank you, Councilman.
239.
Thank you. My two questions are, number one, what system do we have in place now? How is this process handled?
It's for lack of a better term,
yes,
quasi electronic, quasi hand. know, so.
Yeah. Index card?
What does that
color
mean?
Well, I mean,
it's a big very antiquated.
Like it used to be in many departments, and we've consolidated a lot of it. But you know, there's been a lot of silos. You know, every department has its own technology, and this is they have an access program that's used in the police department, and then they send us a spreadsheet, and then we type it in. You know, so it's as I say, it's half automated, half electronic.
My second question is,
how does
this affect our participating police officer?
In the sense of,
does it make it more cumbersome if I were a police officer off duty wanting to participate?
I'm going to say that I believe that it's going to be advantageous in the long run, but that's one of the reasons that we don't want to do a long-term contract, because once the police officers get involved and use it, we're going to get feedback from them. They're going to say, hey, yeah, this is really great. Or they're going to say, oh my gosh, this was not anything what you said it was going to be. So I'm going to reserve comment on that.
I have a question.
There's a couple other towns that are just starting to use it. It's a pretty new service. So again, we're hopeful, and we think certainly from the theoretical, we think it should be much more efficient. But I want to wait and see.
And what's the cap? The cap 17,500.
40,000.
40,000 is the New Jersey cap now.
Yeah, with the QPA.
So we'll do an assessment until we get close. Okay. And then it'll come back for us for consideration.
If we do a million, obviously that'll have to come back here.
See where we are. Okay.
Yep.
All right. Councilman Guarino?
Thank you, Council President. Mr. Gross, thank you. It'll also be scheduling the equipment, the vehicles, and, you know.
They will, I'm certain that as part of that, when people request, depending on what the requests are, whether there's going to be, because they'll be doing the billing for the vehicles as well.
So. Okay. And what equipment is generally used for extra duty?
The only thing we bill for is the cars.
Just the cars. Okay. And are they the newer patrol cars or the older patrol cars?
I don't suspect that I could answer that honestly and say yes. No, I'm sure that it's probably a mixture of what we have.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Gross. Thank you, Council President.
Thank you, Councilman. Anyone else?
I had a few more questions about other,
on that resolution?
Other item. Not on that resolution.
Okay, no, so any
earlier.
Other questions on this resolution?
Are we still pulling that or no?
No, we're not. I'm fine with it. Okay. Thank you. Councilman Krakowiak?
Thank you. So you're not pulling 239. Just had a quick question on Resolution 251-16, which is a lease that we're entering into, our licensing agreement that we're entering into for a property that's part of the redevelopment area, the Central Corridor redevelopment area that we as a township have just gotten, control over through the foreclosure process, the tax foreclosure process. I just noticed that the documentation had originally said that the monthly licensing fee was $500, and then it was crossed out, at least on mine, to $400. And I just wanted to know why that was and what was the licensee paying previously.
So the proposal, well, there's never been a license granted. So, you know, like you just said, we just got site control. So this occupant, I'll use the word, has been on this premises a number of years and basically had a, for lack of a better word, kind of a barter relationship that goes back to Selecto. It doesn't have anything to do with us, but he's basically been on this property. So the minute we got the court order, my book is he's a squatter. The problem is that we have no idea how long this is going to last. And he has been maintaining this property. He's a landscaper. We insisted to get insurance. He got insurance for the town. We insisted to make a proposal. His proposal was only $300. So I was negotiating and I put $500 and it got released to Ms. Carnival before he responded. He said, I can afford $5. And I said, okay. So I said, I presented $4. But it was really an email logistics because Ms. Carnival was adamant to get the stuff by her time on. The day it gets distributed, and I didn't realize, I guess, You did your job.
By ordinance.
But it wasn't quite signed, sealed. It was not your fault at all.
Thank you, Richard.
So that is really just negotiation. And now the hard thing is, this is well below, obviously, the bid threshold, going back to that. So to do a whole process, it's hard to see the upside. You know what I mean? We do it right. We can cancel this at any time with 30 days notice. So there is no, and he's not, there's no money. He's maintaining this. He's also maintaining that lot at 8 Tompkins that you saw. So the upside is, if we don't have him do it, then we are going to have to maintain this all. So it's really not so much about the license fee as it is about having him have insurance and maintain it, including during snow. And as you can imagine, this area, because it's in the middle of being redeveloped, does seem to attract a fair amount of debris that we are trying to be vigilant on.
Plus, having somebody there on a daily basis is toward advantage as well.
Yeah, I saw it was detailed in the contract, so about what he's responsible for. So I like that.
Yeah, I would ask Jack. Remember, it was a PSC depot. I've been asking us to make sure it works. At night, it does. It would be nice to like be able to report it.
Councilman, any more questions?
None on that. I just wanted to move to a couple of other resolutions.
Yes,
resolution number 244-16. This is authorizing the township to accept Essex County's quick claim deed, vacating the road widening easement, and dedicate the proposed 15-foot wide right-of-way along the proposed 5-foot slope easement to the County of Essex via deed of dedication for property located at 296 Prospect Avenue.
Say that in English, please.
Yes.
Right.
Sorry.
Essentially,
I think this, if I understand Mr. Lepore's email, is he still here? Yes, sir.
Yes, he's in
the You might want to come up, Mr. Lepore. I promise this won't be painful. Any more painful than being here at 9 o'clock.
I'll try to make it really short.
Okay.
Before, certainly Mr. Lepore could comment on the particulars of the easement and things of that nature. But the bottom line to this is that we're owed money from Green Acres based on the transactions that had been done before. There was technical requirements, which Lenny can speak to ad nauseum about the significance of those technical requirements. Okay. But the bottom line is nothing changes here other than we get our money if
right.
we pass this.
Yeah. This is property along Prospect that the town owns as open space, and apparently the $120,000 has been hanging around since 2006 that we're finally going to get. Are they going to pay us interest? Okay.
You're going to get paid.
My chief concern is whether there's going to be any change in the usage of that road based upon this document here, the easement. That we're granting. In other words, you know, there's the right turn lane heading north on Prospect. When you get up to Eagle Rock Avenue, there's a cutout lane in front of the service station. I just wanted to see if we were going to have more construction and people need to be aware of that on Prospect, because it's obviously a heavily traveled road.
That certainly is not currently planned by the county. But this certainly would allow them to extend that exclusive right turn lane that's in front of the Exxon down in front of the property towards Boland Drive. It would certainly ease congestion. Mm-hmm. What we're actually doing is the county is giving up a bigger easement in lieu of a smaller dedication of right-of-way.
Okay. If no one has any other questions, I just wanted to move on to another resolution. This is resolution number 25316. This is to this is a water professional services contract for remediation at the old Public Works garage at 6-8 Lindsley. I just wanted to ask a quick question about this, because it's amazing to me that we've already spent almost $700,000 on the remediation, but it looks like this is getting fairly close to finish. Is this is also the former location of the West Orange Board of Education bus garage. Has the Board of Education been assisting in the $687,000 in remediation costs?
I don't think so. Whatever insurance we had on the property, they didn't own the property. We owned the property. We had owned the tank. So it was our responsibility to clean up this.
Okay.
They haven't been on that property since 25 plus years ago.
Okay.
Councilman Koviac, what about 25416 on the snow plowing?
Yeah, I wanted to pull it. If he's up here, I can just ask a couple of quick questions. I don't know whether you were here when we had a discussion about this initially, but I'm trying to get a better understanding I'm sorry, I'm not sure you were here when you heard that my
I don't think he was.
Tale about.
No.
I'm trying not to use my laptop because people complain, and it's making it much more difficult for me to.
It's not a big deal. You
access all my notes. So I'm sorry.
Yeah, if you need it, use it.
One of the things that was so interesting about this was that there were, I think, eight routes, and this company from out of town was the low bidder on all of them.
That's correct.
And by significant amounts, by 20% and 30%, from what I see from excuse me, from the existing rates. But I'm trying to get a feel for why their equipment wouldn't work on certain of the routes, and so we're giving it to another vendor at much higher rates.
When you went into their equipment and reviewed their equipment that they have on hand, they did not have enough equipment that would be suitable for our streets to plow all nine routes, even though they were the low bidder. They had certainly trucks that, in a certain sense, would exceed our specification. They were much bigger trucks, however, not appropriate for our streets. If we were plowing Route 280, they'd be very appropriate for Route 280, but not for our residential streets. And not because of the weight of the truck. It's the maneuverability of the truck. Lots of intersections constantly backing up just weren't appropriate. But they did have five trucks that were appropriate for our street, and they were awarded five routes.
Okay. There was one award that I wanted to ask you about, because it looked like they had the equipment and yet they didn't win the award. That's why I need my laptop to try to figure this out. They were was it the St. Cloud, one of the routes in St. Cloud, I think it was the LG2, required a Ford F700, which they apparently had, and yet it was awarded to another vendor at a much higher rate. Does that ring a bell?
Yeah, yes, okay. It does. What if they were to be awarded that route, they could have still been awarded five routes. But then I would not have any vendor, or I wouldn't be able to award for the lowest price any of the other three routes. I shouldn't say any of them. Two of the others I could award, and the third one would be awarded at an even higher price. So I put the lowest bidder in five routes, and the next lowest bidder in the next three routes, and that was the limit of the award.
Correct.
So if I were to take the one bidder and put him in St. Cloud, that would have precluded that bidder from working anywhere else, and he was lower than another bidder, which was Downs Tree Service.
So you assess the equipment inventory, the overall equipment inventory, not based on route, but rather on overall equipment inventory.
Well, in this case, it was a combination of inventory and what was the combination of vendors that would give us the least cost, because the second low vendor only bid three routes, and if he was not to get St. Cloud, then he wouldn't have been able to be awarded any other route, and then I would have gone to the third highest bidder for one of the two routes that he bid.
Okay.
Well done, Len.
Can I ask a question?
Puzzle.
Council President?
Yes.
Can I ask a question?
Councilman Koviac,
Sorry. Are you done, Councilman? Take your time.
Staying I'm sorry. Resolution. I'm going to go through my paper blizzard.
Well, let him speak while you get your notes together.
Let Councilman Koviac get his thing on. Just keep on one track for a second.
Okay. No, that's okay. I just, I thought this was such good news because we're going to save a lot of money, and the more snow, we're going to save more than we were than we did last year. So I thought it was a good idea, but I couldn't figure out that one round.
Nobody's wishing for snow.
No.
Right.
No, I didn't know. Right.
Okay. That's all I had.
Thank you.
Mr.
LaPorte, hi. Thank you for being here tonight. Just a question. I know it's not supposed to affect the bid either. I'm just having a question. Okay. Do you ever take into consideration previous past performances by the vendors?
We do, but I think under the local public contract law, we have to have had a prior negative experience to be able to disqualify somebody.
Just a quick question. I assume
we document them.
It's got to be documented. It's got to be documented.
And you do document, right? I mean, you do take consideration resident complaints and, you know, our own rogue people, like Mr. Williams goes out or the guys go out, they see.
It wouldn't be a snowstorm without a resident complaint.
Okay.
Okay, so are we not going that question. One now?
I have one more question.
Thank you. On the same resolution.
Yes. So, Lynn, at the league last week, there were so many sessions on stormwater management, and stormwater management regulations have changed. Do any of these vendors use, are they using anything that's a little more environmentally friendly than what we have used in the past?
We're supplying all the materials, so they're using the same de-icing materials that we're using.
And are they? Avoiding the question. What was that?
And there was calcium chloride, which is our typical road salt. Okay. Nothing.
Nothing organic about that.
Friendly,
no.
No organic products. No.
Okay. Thank you, Councilwoman.
Thanks, sir.
Okay, so are we not pulling that now?
Councilman Corvia?
Yeah, I don't need to pull that now.
All right.
I was afraid he wasn't here and I couldn't get the answers. Okay. But
thank you, Mr. LaPorte.
He magically appeared because he hadn't been here for...
He knew.
I also have one more resolution, Resolution 252-16. This is the resolution approving various outstanding tax appeals.
Yes. That's pulled unless you just have questions.
Oh, it is pulled. Okay.
Yeah,
no, that's fine. If it's pulled, then we can just deal with it then.
Okay.
Thank you for
thank you, Councilman.
Your patience.
Question?
Yeah. Oh, are we done? I think we're not done pulling asking questions, I thought.
Oh, no, we're not. I mean, if you have more questions.
Okay. Please. This one was for John. This is Resolution 250-16 about the appropriation transfer for the gasoline.
Yes.
With the 23-cent tax on gas, does that affect that transfer?
I think it would be fine.
Thank you.
Are we tax exempt?
Yes.
Oh, I didn't know that.
New York.
Oh, here, and I just have a question here on 247-16. I made a note on the raffle licenses. They're dated 2015.
15?
247. Just take a peek, I think. Okay. Let me find it.
I think they have things here.
Not on there unless they were changed. Someone, when I looked at it on there. Okay.
They're good?
They're good.
I have a question. It's okay. It's just typo. It's just like, Resolution 241-16, appointing the Lenny LaPorte. It sounds like you're appointing a group. Okay. It's like, so, all right. And it has to end.
It's the Lenny LaPorte.
Okay. That's accurate, Councilman.
Okay.
That's accurate.
The infamous. Okay.
That's not a type.
All right. And is Rock Spring Country Club, I mean, isn't that Montclair Country Club now?
Yeah, they are.
Then why is it saying Rock Spring Country Club?
It's a form that's been used for years.
Mm-hmm. I know, but still, I mean, do we want to be, I mean, in perfect contact?
It's not called Montclair Country
Club.
Yeah,
no.
It's not assume the name the
it's
signs
It's Montclair today. Country Club at Rock Spring. That's the official.
Well, then that's what it, okay.
It's for Santa.
Okay, it's for Santa, forget it, okay. You get it.
I don't think he.
It's going to be Evil Santa.
Well, we want to make sure he lands in the right place.
In the right place.
Okay, that's your point, right?
That's my point.
His GPS might send him to Prospect.
Thank you for your input. Thanks for the clarification.
Thank you, Councilman.
Santa Tracker.
So I don't have another question, but I do want to just note that if we're putting together the consent agenda item J says the related ordinance must be approved before
That's
we...
That's been pulled.
It's been pulled.
Oh, it's been pulled? Okay, I'm sorry. Yeah. Missed that, too. Apologize. Yes.
I think the only ones now that have been pulled are J and Q.
Correct.
Yes.
That's what I have.
Madam Clerk?
Okay. Is there a motion to approve the consent agenda?
So moved.
Second.
Second. All in favor?
Aye. Aye.
Any opposed? The consent agenda is implemented.
Okay.
So resolution 245-16, resolution authorization for sale of notes, special emergency appropriations, severance liabilities resulting from accrued leave in connection with the layoff or retirement of employees. That's it, of employees.
But we can't do that until we approve the ordinance.
Yeah. I'm sorry. You're right. You just said that. I apologize. Okay, so resolution 252-16, resolution approving various outstanding tax appeals. Councilman Krakowiak, you pulled that.
Thank you. I this is somewhat of an unusual request in that typically when we get property tax appeals, they're in a slightly different format, and it's at least from my perspective, it's easier to.
This is actually a different action than what you're referring to. The ones that we usually send out with the property tax bills, and you will get those when we actually pay them.
Yeah, that was my question too.
That will happen later on. These will not be paid until 2017. But these are stipulation settlements because of the size and nature of them. We talked about it, and we felt that it was important that we put it before council. Just so that you're quite frankly aware of them and the size and the nature of them.
Yeah, well, that's what's concerning me. And not so much, I don't have the expertise to go in and challenge any of the proposed settlements, but what strikes me here is that there are 50.
It's sizable.
Yeah, it's 50,
it's sizable.
52 separate tax appeals. They all look like they're for big commercial buildings, and all but one of them, I think, reduces the assessed value and therefore would reduce the revenue going forward.
What we're trying to accomplish here, these are the bulk of the remaining commercial appeals. There may be a few more coming along over the next month or two, but if you remember, over the past 5 years since I've got here, when I first came, I identified to council that we had hanging over our heads significant amounts of commercial appeals, and we have in a manner of to try to do them in certain tranches that we could afford, and I put that in quotes, trying to deal with them. We're putting these before you. This is the lion's share of what's left, and we want to get them approved. So now, as opposed to after the first of the year, so that we can reduce the assessments and, quite frankly, stop the bleeding. These are sizable. They're very old. A lot of them are pretty old, they're significant. The terms of dollars, I haven't done the calculations on them yet, but it's probably reaching up in the $2 million area in terms of it. But again, you know, if we don't do those, that means next year, you know, a portion of that, probably maybe up $400,000 to $500,000, we would lose in addition in 2017. So that's why it's important to get these done. We believe that this will bring us near the end of the commercial tax appeals, and which have been a drain on our total assessed value over the years.
Right. Some of these go back, I saw a couple that went go back to 2009.
Mm-hmm.
But here's my question. Exactly what is, as far as you can say, what is the impact? You mentioned $2 million. Is that a run rate? So next year we're going to have $2 million less in tax revenue because of this? Or are you saying it's $2 million for...
No. I'm doing a hypothetical. If somebody has, if we have tax appeals between 2016 to 2009, that's eight years of taxes. So if it was 200,000 a year, that'd be 1.6 million. So next year it's not 1.6 million, it's 200,000. So it's just because of multi. If we didn't do this,
then next year we'd have the same bleeding, so it wouldn't be 1.6, it'd be 1.8. And the year after that, it'd be $2 million. So it's, at some point in time, you got to settle these things up.
No, I understand that. I'm just trying to get a quantification of what the impact is going to be, because it seems like it's going to cost us more than $2 million just to settle these 56, 57.
Well, again, I haven't done the math on those yet, because we'll certainly do that. But frankly, while I certainly respect and understand that the council is concerned about the dollar amounts, the basis by which the judgment is made on here is not about how much money it's worth. The question is whether or not it's a valid assessment. And our professionals believe that these settlements represent the best case scenario for us, rather than going to court.
I understand.
To settle them, that this ultimately is the best value that we're going to get on these properties. And by doing it, as I said before, and I'll be redundant, by doing it now, we stop the bleeding this year and don't continue it into the future, which we could do, and we have done. But now it's time to solidify that. Right. We will do the math for it. Again, we just got them ourselves in total. So to sit down and actually do it, I'll be happy to provide that for you, at a future meeting. Certainly, okay. When we come back to pay them, you're going to have the mm-hmm. math.
Because it looks it looks devastating to me. It looks it looks devastating to me.
Well,
in terms of the reductions in the assessment, which all are going to be associated with the tax rates on the year. We've got 100 Executive Drive. We had it down as an assessed value of $15.3 million in 2011. It's being cut almost in half to less than $8.5 million under this proposal. I mean, that's just...
We understand.
That's just huge. And that's just one of them.
There's no question that this is, this is important. From a cash flow perspective, I've been kind of pushing these off, because next year, after 2017, we're going to get an $800,000 savings, because some of the tax appeals that we've been paying for will be paid off, and I'm going to use that money to finance these over the next 3, 4, 5 years. So, this is part of the plan, and to try to settle all these, and again, this brings us near the end, without... If we settled all 3 or 4 years ago, the taxpayers would have been hit with a really gigantic amount of money that they would have to come up with, because they don't let you finance them out a certain period of time. They don't let you go forever, so you can do the same amount of money every year for 10 years. You can't do that. So this really has been the best case scenario for solving, the outcome of the last reval. And when you have revals, the commercial properties are the ones that you have to worry about, coming back on you. And that's where we are. And the bottom line to it is, there's really no other alternative at this point. And waiting only is going to make it worse and more difficult for the taxpayer. If we do it now, we'll be able to finance it in 2017, and then start paying in 2018 when we get the relief from the last tranche.
So when you say finance in 2017, are you talking about issuing more debt?
Has to be, sure. Absolutely has to be.
And do you have any idea how much that...
Well, I don't know what the rates are going to be, but, right now, our last ban was about...
I know, we just were talking about
was a little bit more than 1%. So, it's not... Again, percentage-wise, the rate... we were at one point in time, we were paying 0.4. So, yes. They're more than doubled, but she's still only at 1%. So it's not astronomical. Even on the short term, and these are all short term notes, they'll never go long. The historic average on short term notes is 2%. So I don't see this as being a problem from us from a financing point of view at all. If we had to pay it out and we didn't finance it, we have that choice. But then I'd be coming back to you and say, here's what we're talking about next year for tax increase, which all are going to look at me and say, you can't do that. So this is the alternative.
No, our debt service, as I'm sure better than anybody else, is up like 45% in the last 4 or 5 years. And it's like $2.5 million that we're spending on debt service now that we were spending on, uniforms and payroll and that sort of thing. So I'm just concerned about that. But maybe at the next council meeting, would that give you enough time to make a presentation on the impact?
Yeah, we won't be paying them until next year. So I'll depending on... to be honest with you, Councilman, I'll do my best on it, but this transition on the Kronos project is all-encompassing. So
I just would, okay.
I will certainly get it for you. I just don't want to guarantee it.
That's understandable. I just would like to have it before we enter into budget.
Councilman, since we had a lengthy discussion, I guess you can just explain to the public what we're talking about.
Yeah.
Okay? There was a tax appeal, right? A judge ruled whether or not the tax appeal was successful. Our hands are tied. We can't do anything about it. We talked about executive drive. It goes down from $12 million down to $8 million. What is under the township's control?
Well, our professionals believe that if we continue with the process, we'll end up not being as good as a situation that we're in now.
The markets are shifting. We talked about that. Interest rates are going up. We're going to have to borrow to pay. We're talking about millions of dollars of money that we have to return. Well, what are we going to do, right? We can't pay out a budget.
Again, since we've been financing over time, that some of that is coming due, and we're not going to have to pay in 2018. So we're going to use that money to pay this. So there is a plan in place so that this will not have a tremendous impact, a negative impact on our taxpayers.
We're trying to
smooth that out.
Right.
That's what we try to do. That's one of the reasons you finance. You finance so that you don't have a big hit. You try to make it smooth.
Which goes back to Councilman Corvia's point and Councilwoman Castellino in terms of keeping an eye out on that debt ratio as we proceed and we consider taking on more debt. So thank you. Councilman, any more questions? 252-16? Seeing none, Madam Clerk.
That's fine. Thank you.
Is there a motion to adopt Resolution 252-16?
So moved.
Second.
Councilwoman Castellino?
Yes.
Councilman Guarino?
Yes.
Councilman Krakowiak?
Yes.
Councilwoman McCartney?
Yes.
Council President Cirillo?
Yes.
Okay, the motion is carried. And we can go on to ordinances now since we have to wait on that other resolution. Okay, ordinances on second and final reading, Ordinance 2494-16, an ordinance authorizing special emergency appropriation pursuant to NJSA 40-53 for severance liabilities resulting from accrued leave in connection with the layoff or retirement of employees. Is there a motion to introduce on second and final reading?
So moved.
Motion moved.
Second.
Councilwoman Castellino?
Yes.
Councilman Guarino?
Yes.
Councilman Krakowiak?
Yes.
Councilwoman McCartney?
Yes.
Council President Cirillo?
Yes. Any member of the public wishes to speak on 2494-16? Seeing none, Madam Clerk.
Discussion amongst council.
We're going to move on to discussion.
Yeah.
Second reading. Councilman,
just want to let everybody know this is something that's become an annual foray for us. This is not to fund layoffs. This is to fund severance liabilities for people who are retiring. They get their vacation and, I guess, their health care. So this year, we're estimating it's going to be $600,000. And so we're authorizing an emergency appropriation, which may or may not result in additional borrowing.
Right.
And it's actually, again, if I could find my notes, you were very helpful in giving me the numbers on previous years. Let's see, 2013, we actually had a $1.2 million emergency appropriation for this. 2014, it was originally $1 million, but we only borrowed about $650,000. Last year was $800,000, so this is lower than that. But I just wanted everybody to know what we were talking about here.
Thank you, Councilman. Anyone else? Madam Clerk?
Okay. Is there a motion to adopt Ordinance 2494-16?
So moved.
Second.
Councilwoman Castellino?
Yes.
Councilman Guarino?
Yes.
Councilman Krakowiak?
Yes.
Councilwoman McCartney?
Yes.
Council President Cirillo?
Yes.
Okay. Ordinance 2495-16, an ordinance amending Chapter 12, Section 11.6 of the Revised General Ordinances, e-cigarette licensing. Is there a motion to introduce on second and final reading?
So moved.
Second.
Councilwoman Castellino?
Yes.
Councilman Guarino?
Yes.
Councilman Krakowiak?
Yes.
Councilwoman McCartney?
Yes.
Council President Cirillo?
Yes. Any comments?
No, public comments first. You have to ask.
Any member of the public? Counsel?
I was just going to say, and maybe...
What?
Maybe I'm Councilman Guarino would want it because it was his original stuff. I just wanted to make sure it just got explained, that's all.
Yes, it did. No. Thank you, Councilman. No, it did. And it's something that had to be done and adjusted. And, you know, I think, you know, it really behooves us to move this forward and to generate these revenues. So that's...
Okay, but we're asking you to read it. It says the minimum fixed penalty imposed for violation of municipal ordinances
is $100. And the maximum is $2,000.
There you go. This is on e-cigarette licensing.
Right.
And in our original legislation, we didn't have numbers, a number that complied with the state. And so now we're just changing it now to fix this.
Correct. Thank you, Councilman.
And as you know, I opposed this originally, but obviously to fix something like this, I'm going to vote for it.
Thank you, Councilman.
Madam Clerk?
Is there a motion to adopt Ordinance 2495-16?
So moved.
Second.
Councilwoman Castellino?
Yes.
Councilman Guarino?
Yes.
Councilman Krokoviak?
Yes.
Councilwoman McCartney?
Yes.
Council President Cirillo?
Yes.
Okay. Ordinance is on first reading. 2496-16, an ordinance creating a reclassification and salary schedule of certain Township of West Orange employees, setting forth their titles, classification, and salary ranges, and adopting a salary guide and establishing employee status as a Township employee and under the guidelines of the New Jersey Department of Personnel. Did you want to discuss before I do the motion?
Yeah, we decided to.
Yes.
Yes.
So that's...
Okay. Compilation of titles, Mr. Gross.
Yeah, this is pretty much a housekeeping ordinance update. And going through our time management system, we found some errors or inconsistencies. So they're basically correcting that. You know, there were a couple of errors that will impact employees because they, you know, we were underpaying them because of the ordinance, and that occurred. Relatively similar. No, he wasn't. You were wrong.
Darn.
But it's a relatively small amount of money.
So. Any questions? Comments? Madam Clerk, okay. 2497.
Is there a motion to adopt on, approve on first reading? So 2496.
Second.
Councilwoman Castellino?
Yes.
Councilman Guarino?
Yes.
Councilman Krokoviak?
Yes.
Councilwoman McCartney?
Yes.
Council President Cirillo?
Yes.
Ordinance 2497-16, an ordinance amending and supplementing Chapter 7, Traffic, Subsection 7-32.1, Handicap Parking on Streets, and Subsection 7-32.2, Restricted Parking Zones of the Revised General Ordinances, 13 Cross Street, 54 Ashland Avenue, and 24 Ashwood Terrace. Discussion?
No, I just want to ask to make sure there's an inventory kept, because sometimes people move out, and we want to make sure that those handicapped spots get put back into the non-handicap inventory.
Correct.
I have a question for Mr. Lepore, if you don't mind, on how you determine these. I mean, if they have... obviously I know the criteria, someone's handicapped, but if you have a driveway and if these were folks that are tenants or
usually in most cases they're tenants or it's a house with no driveway.
Okay.
So
you go there on site inspection, make sure. Okay. I know with parking so tight on some of these streets, that was my concern.
Thank you. Questions or points?
No,
comments?
That was my question.
Is there a motion to approve on first reading 2497-16?
So moved.
Second.
Okay. Councilwoman Castellino?
Yes.
Councilman Guarino?
Yes.
Councilman Krokoviak?
Yes.
Councilwoman McCartney?
Yes.
Council President Cirillo?
Yes.
Okay. Now we have to go back to resolution
245-16?
Yes. Right. Resolution authorization for sale of notes, special emergency appropriations, severance liabilities resulting from accrued leave in connection with the layoff or retirement of employees. Is there any discussion?
No. We've already discussed it.
This is a companion resolution to the ordinance that was adopted.
Correct. Is there a motion to adopt?
So moved. Second.
Oh. Okay. Councilwoman Castellino?
Yes.
Councilman Guarino?
Yes.
Councilman Krokoviac?
Yes.
Councilwoman McCartney?
Yes.
Council President Cirillo?
Yes.
Okay. And I believe that concludes our agenda.
Thank you, Madam Clerk. We're going to move on to pending matters.
Oh, wait, I'm sorry. Yeah.
Pending matters and then zoning attendance.
Yes, sorry. Yep.
He just went outside.
Yes, I'm sorry. There is pending matters, new matters.
Pending matters, new matters, council discussion. Any matters that council wish to address at this point in general?
Well, there is a matter on the agenda for zoning board member reappointment. Yeah.
Any other matters?
And I have one other matter.
There's also a vacancy that I've proposed a nominee, Dr. Straker.
All four? Yeah. Okay, so where do we start? Let's start with Alt 1, Alternative 1 for the Zoning Board, a reappointment.
Yeah.
I agree. Oh. Yeah, yes. Bart? Yeah.
I agree. Also, just to note that Mr. Quinzel, if possible, if there's anyone has an appointment that doesn't want to be reappointed, he'd like to move up to a full-time appointment in the future. So that possibility ever comes up,
Terrific.
Like to be considered.
Okay.
Great.
Make a nomination that Mr. Kinzel be appointed as the alternative number one member of the zoning board.
I'll move that.
Second.
Okay, so who, Michelle, you moved mm-hmm. it first?
And Councilwoman McCartney seconded.
Okay. And all in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed? Okay, so that's good. And then, did you want to discuss alternate number four?
Yes, I'm going to yield the floor to Councilman Krokoviac. He has an appointment. I don't know if there is anyone else that has anyone.
I'm looking.
Mind? Are we, no.
Okay. Not at this
Councilman
time.
Councilman Krokoviac.
I just wanted to nominate Dr. Michael Straker. Very impressive guy. He's a physician. He's a OBGYN. He's an undergrad at Johns Hopkins and did his medical training at Mount Sinai. A very impressive guy. He's relatively young. He's got young kids, but he really wants to get involved with the town. And I spoke with him some time ago, and he expressed interest. And this vacancy came up, and I think this is a really good fit for him. So I just ask the council to please consider approving him as alternate four.
Any discussion?
I'm thinking of somebody else. I mean, I was going to ask somebody else.
Anyone else? Okay, seeing none.
Did you make a motion for that?
I have not made a motion.
Okay, I just wanted to understand.
Okay. Okay, I mean, are we ready to vote on a nomination, or does anyone else need more time?
Well, there is no nomination.
Okay.
I need more time.
Okay. So, would you wish to make the nomination?
Yes, I move that we approve Dr. Michael Straker as alternate number four as the council's appointment to the zoning board.
Is there a second?
Yes.
Yeah. Second. There is a second by you, Councilwoman. Okay. Okay. And who is in favor?
Aye.
Yeah, I'm fine.
One, two. Victor
yes.
in favor?
Yeah.
Four. Councilman Guarino?
No.
Okay.
Well, do you have somebody now or no?
No.
Okay.
What?
You don't have anybody.
But does this have to be by full consent of the council?
Majority vote.
All right, so the motion is carried.
Mm-hmm. Thank you, everyone.
Thank you.
Now I have one other matter that's not listed, I'm sorry, but council meeting dates. Did you want to, because Shari needs to book the room, so that's the only reason why I'm pushing it.
We talked
about it last time.
It's okay.
And there was one concern in December.
There was a conflict, right, with Hanukkah and Christmas?
Correct.
Oh, for
and
next
I
year.
Went back and I checked the different dates with the different boards. Actually, there was a question about November and December. So on 11-1, the planning board meets. 11-16, the zoning board meets.
Okay, so... So when's the last one in November?
The only one in November right now is scheduled for the 21st. It's similar to what we did this year. We had one meeting in November.
Wait, it's 21st again next year? Because this was a Monday.
It's 21st next year.
Also, oh, is there no leap year?
Tuesday, 21st.
Oh, that's right, Tuesday.
Right.
Sorry, it's my husband's birthday now.
So is that okay to go forward with the one meeting in November?
I think that's okay.
Okay.
Because the other one was so late in October.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
Is everyone in agreement with that?
Oh, yeah, because there's an election that, yeah, election.
Yeah.
Yeah. I'm fine.
I'm sorry, what's the date?
November 21st, okay. Tuesday. The Tuesday before Thanksgiving.
Okay.
You'll give us a calendar next meeting,
thank
right?
You.
I mean,
I'll have the schedule done, yeah.
So November 21st is the only meeting we're having in?
Correct.
Okay.
All right, so that's that. And then December... We have 12-6, the planning board meets, 12-20, Downtown West Orange Alliance, and 12-21, zoning. It's a very, very busy month.
So those were all Wednesdays, though, so...
And your recommendation was what, the 13th?
Well, we had Tuesday the 5th, and then we talked about the week of Hanukkah. So Hanukkah's over on the 19th, or the 19th, the 20th would be the Downtown West Orange Alliance, and the 21st is the zoning board.
Why aren't they usually earlier in the month?
Zoning's up is the third month. Thursday.
I can't do the 22nd.
Well, the 19th would work, I think, because isn't it end at?
Well, that's what I originally had.
That it begins at sunset.
Do we care if there's a Board of Ed meeting or we don't?
Oh, so it begins on the 19th.
Right.
I thought it ended.
That was the question.
I thought it ended on the 19th.
It ends. It begins here. On the 12th and ends on the 20th at sunset, and that's the night Downtown West Orange Alliance meets.
Okay, so the 19th would still be Hanukkah, so
correct.
We should not schedule that, okay?
Exactly. So, it's just a very busy month.
It still
from,
the
from the administration's point of view, there's no urgency since we recessed the 6th meeting
correct.
Until the 1st meeting.
That's
so,
true.
In terms of from business point of view, we have, you know, no urgency if you ultimately decide only to have one meeting in December.
Right.
I understand that, you know, just want to let you know that, you know, sometimes that's a consideration, but we won't have any issue with that. Right.
And then if we need an emergency meeting, we could...
You could always add it.
Do that.
Absolutely.
So then we keep the 5th?
Just the 5th.
Otherwise, you're looking at the last week in December, which, you know, a lot of people are away or whatever.
So is that okay for now?
Yes.
Mr. Sayers, is that the time? Yeah.
Okay. Yes.
So then we're done with our business.
All right, thank you all. Have a happy Thanksgiving, everyone, with your families.
Yes.
Thank you.
Beautiful families, enjoy, smile, beautiful day.
Is there a motion to adjourn?
I make a motion to adjourn.
Thank you.
Second.
Thank you. All in favor?
Aye.